The date is October 30th, 1997. The survivor is Sigmund Tobias. The interviewer is Martha Fraser. The city and state are Teaneck, New Jersey. The country, United States of America. The language is English. My name is Martha Fraser, M-A-R-T-H-A-F-R-A-Z-E-R. I'm conducting an interview with Sigmund Tobias on October 30th, 1997 in Teaneck, New Jersey, the United States of America, in the English language. Please state and spell your name.
Sigmund, S-I-G-M-U-N-D, Tobias, T-O-B-I-A-S.
Was this your name at birth?
Yes, it was.
Was there ever a time when you had another name?
Yes, there was. Beginning in 1937, our family name was switched to Winstrauch as a result of the Nuremberg laws. My father's parents were married in the synagogue and didn't have a legal ceremony, as was common in Poland. So he was required, the Nazis considered that marriage illegitimate, and he was required to assume his mother's maiden name, as is common among illegitimate children. So beginning in 37, we were known as Winstrauch, W-I-N-D-S-T-R-A-U-C-H. And I always felt that was a phony name, in addition to the fact that I hated it. And in 1955, when I became a citizen of the United States, with my parents, we resumed our family name of Tobias.
What is your birth date and current age?
November 26, 1932. That makes me 64, I guess. Almost 65, come to think of it.
Please state and spell your city and country of birth.
I was born in Berlin, B-E-R-L-I-N, Germany.
Could you please tell us your parents' names?
Yes, my father's name was Moses Tobias, M-O-S-E-S. My mother's name was Frieda, F-R-I-E-D-A. Geschwind was her maiden name, and of course her married name was Tobias.
Did you have any siblings?
No, I'm an only child.
Were your parents originally from Berlin, or?
No, both my parents were born in Poland. My mother was born in Szendeshev, which was a small city in what was called Galicia, which we visited, as a matter of fact, every year for the summer through 1938, I believe. My father was born in Nowosanz, also a small city in Poland. He came to Berlin in the 20s, I don't remember exactly when, and worked in Berlin. And then my mother arrived in Berlin in the early 30s. She worked for her sister, whose husband had a textile and ready-made clothing store. And that's where they met, and then they were married in Berlin. I guess they were married in 30 or 31, I'm not sure of that. And I was born, of course, in 1932.
Please describe the area of Berlin in which you lived.
I lived in 38 Metz. Now, actually, we lived in Petersburger Straße, but I have no personal memories of that. My memories begin with Metzerstraße, which was a street in what used to be East Berlin, and I think it was 38 Metzerstraße. I have a picture of myself in front of the house, which we can look at, yes, later on. We revisited Metzerstraße when I went back to Germany many years later and found that the building was still intact, though the building was built, they had a sort of a front area, and then there was a courtyard, and then there was the rear area wrapped around. The rear had been bombed away where we lived, but the front part was intact. And the thing that I remember vividly about the street was that they had a strip of benches and trees in the center. And during the Hitler period, I remember vividly a day when a detail of, I can't remember whether they uniformed or not, but the German men went from bench to bench, and they put down Juden verboten, Jews forbidden. And then there was one bench when it said, I think fear Juden, or that Jews were permitted. And that was the bench which was, of course, most frequently occupied by Germans. So if Jews wanted to sit there, we couldn't. That's about the clearest memory I have, though when I returned, I don't think there were any more benches there. I don't remember for sure.
What was your apartment like?
Oh, my recollection is that it was a three-room apartment, a big bedroom, and then there was a living room area where I had a bed. Then there was a huge kitchen, a large kitchen, and the thing I remember vividly about it is that it had sort of a tile stove, which provided the major heating. And it was always very nice to sit near the tiles and put my hands on the tiles because they were very warm. And as was typical of many houses, even apartment houses in that area, they were heated by coal. We would bring up pails of coal and put them into the oven.
What were the bathroom facilities in your apartment?
I don't remember. Clearly, I imagine it was running water, a regular water closet, different from what we had later in China.
What were your neighbors like?
The neighbors I recall most vividly were people who ultimately followed us to Shanghai. They were called the Atamans. They lived across the street, across the courtyard in the same building, 38. And that was a family of five, actually, the parents. And then there was Rita, who was about 5 or 6 years older than I, and two brothers, Willie and Henry, Heinz, we call them. Subsequently, he went to Israel in 36, 37, which was, of course, a very wise decision. And the rest of the family followed my parents and me to Shanghai. And we lived in the same house in Shanghai. I remember them most vividly because we had a lot of contact with them in Shanghai. I really don't remember any other neighbors. I was a little older than six when we left Berlin, so my memories tend to be of only the most vivid moments of that period.
What was your father doing for a living in Berlin?
My father was a peddler. He sold textiles. And what was fairly common in those times that there'd be three or four Jewish guys whom he knew. Generally, they were all Polish origin. And one of them had a car, and they would split the expenses. Then he would go away for, he would take textiles on consignment from a large textile dealer, and they would cut them into, I imagine they were 3-yard batches. And they would go from door to door in the villages, selling them to people in the villages, because it was customary then that people sewed their own clothes, and he would sell these textiles. And if he did very well, he'd be home in a few days, otherwise it would take, but it was rarely that he'd be gone for more than a week. And my most vivid memories are of him coming back and invariably came back with toys. There were huge batches of toys. I remember him having gone touring the cell in Thüringen, which was a capital of making toys. And he brought back gorgeous toys, and I remember quite vividly waiting for his return because I'd have lots of toys, new toys to play with.
Can you describe one or two of your favorite toys?
Oh, yeah. I remember vividly that one of my favorite toys was was a kind of a complex arrangement of a carriage with horses. And there was some kind of a uniformed person sitting in front, and then there was this carriage with a couple of people in the rear, and there were four horses, and they were pulling this thing along, and the horses had little wheels, so I could actually pull them along the apartment. And that was kind of exciting. And then there were a number of cars, different kinds, trucks, cars, fire engines, things of that kind.
What materials were they made out of?
Wood. Typically made of wood. I don't remember any of them being motorized. They were usually the kinds of things which you'd pull along, and they were made, and they were painted usually shining red, very vivid colors. And it was a very exciting time when he came back, especially when it was a successful trip, because there were obviously more toys when the trip was not too successful. But I had lots of those, and that was always a fun time.
You mentioned that your mother had worked in her sister's store.
Yeah.
Did she do this after her marriage?
No, not. She may have done it after her marriage, but she didn't do it after I was born. Though when my father was on the road, we spent a lot of time with my family, with her, my aunt and uncle, whose name was Jaffe. And they lived on Petersburger Straße, and they had a, I guess it was mainly ready-made clothes and some loose textiles that they sold there. And I spent time both in the store and in the apartment, got to know them both pretty well, because I guess my mother was reasonably lonely, so we spent a lot of time there. And we also, she had another sister living in Berlin. We spent some time there. Her name was Sarah Blaufeld, and her husband's name was Isaac Blaufeld. And I had two cousins there, one of whom survived. Zalo Blaufeld survived, and his sister Puppa, who did not. And the Jaffes had two sons, both of whom survived and are in the United States, Max and Ziggy. And I remember spending a lot of time with them when I was a kid.
Did you also spend time playing with children in the neighborhood?
Some. I went to, I think it must have been the equivalent of nursery school or kindergarten in the synagogue school, the Rieckerstrasse Synagogue. And I don't have too many memories of that because I wasn't there for very long. The thing that I recall vividly is that frequently the Nazi kids would wait for us outside of the synagogue school when school was over. They'd wait for us and they would taunt us, and occasionally they would throw stones at us and spit at us. And one of my vivid recollections is running away from a group of kids who were pursuing me, and I remember well running up to a policeman, and he looked gigantic to me, especially the German policemen were called Schupo, which is short for Schutzpolizei. And they wore kind of a triangular hat, which made this guy appear even taller than he was. And I ran up to him, and he seemed gigantic, and I was panting and really terrified, and telling him these kids were going to beat me up. And he said, well, we'll see about that. And then the kids caught up to me, and the lead kid said, he's a Jew, he's Jewish, as Judah. And the thing I remember is a cop turning his back to me. And fortunately, I made it home without them pursuing me. I don't think I ever went back to that school again. And I imagine shortly thereafter, the school was disbanded.
In your home, how were you and your family observing Judaism?
Yeah, we were relatively Orthodox Jews. We always had a kosher home and observed the Sabbath as far as we could. I believe my parents were somewhat more casual with regard to turning on the lights and things like that, but the home was kosher and all the high holidays were observed. And we'd go to the Rikerstrasse synagogue, and I remember going to that synagogue quite regularly, where I had my first Hebrew instruction. I think after the school disbanded, I recall also getting some Hebrew lessons where there would be a tutor who came to our house, a teacher. And I know that I learned how to read Hebrew before I learned how to read German. As a matter of fact, I never really learned how to read German. I learned how to read English ultimately and then learned German. But I read Hebrew quite early. Now, whether I was 4 or 5 at the time, I can't recall. But I do recall quite vividly reading Hebrew before that and being able to read the prayer book.
You mentioned taking trips to your mother's home in Poland.
Mm-hmm.
Can you describe some of these trips for us?
Oh, yeah. We went every summer. My father usually, being a peddler, it was obviously easiest to travel in the summer. The weather being most benign, going door to door made it easy. So he was on the road quite frequently for a month or two at a time in the summer. And invariably, my mother visited her family. Her family had an egg importing and exporting business, and they had 3 branches. The major part of the business was in a town called Shendyshov, which was in Galicia. And they had a big house there. And the thing that I remember very vividly about it is that was in the basement, they had huge tubs in which the eggs were laid. The eggs, they were bought eggs from the peasants. And they were in some kind of clay which preserved them. I don't understand how that worked, but that's what they did at the time. And they would lay them in layers of clay, and then be more eggs, and then be more layers. And I remember that was a source of some fascination, as was the fact that the family having this business had a truck, which was relatively rare in those times, of course. And the driver, a man I grew very fond of by the name of Shoal, and he would often take me for rides on the truck. We had the family had a business also in a smaller town called Dembitz, and another town called Katowice. And I remember frequently, Dembitz was perhaps a 45-minute to an hour truck ride from Shendyshev. And Shoal and I would with some frequency go there on errands, either to pick up eggs or bring back stuff. And he would pretend to let me drive the truck, so he would sort of put me on his lap and let me hold the steering wheel. And those were very exciting times. And we would be singing Polish and Yiddish songs along the road. And they, of course, made me promise never to tell my mother about the fact that I was driving the truck. And those were very exciting times. And as a matter of fact, I recall my mother was quite concerned about my relationship with Shoal, because she told me not to speak so much about Shoal when I returned to Germany to my father, because she was afraid to make my father jealous. And I imagine it might have, because having, you know, access to supposedly driving a truck when I was 4 or 5, this was just terribly exciting. And I looked forward to those times. And also, as a city kid in Berlin, Shendyshev was a small village, and it was a farm village, and it was a very different environment. There were many grass fields and stuff. And I remember getting involved with the local kids in the town. We did We would throw eggs to see who could throw furthest, and typically the family would give me the rotten eggs, which couldn't be used for anything. And I was quite valued by the kids because there was this field in front of the house where we'd throw eggs. And every once in a while, of course, I'd steal a few good eggs when we didn't have enough rotten eggs. I'd catch hell from my family about that. But I remember those times as being a lot of fun. What was hard for me to understand, these kids who were supposedly my friends, every once in a while when something unpleasant would happen, they would curse me. And I remember the word jid, which I guess is equivalent to kike in Polish. And the venom and bitterness with which they spat that out was even shaking to me then. And it was difficult for me to really understand. Here, you know, on some days we were playing, and the other days I would be cursed out really quite viciously. But most of the kids I played with in Shendershiv, who happened to be my peers, were not Jewish. There were a few Jewish kids, but most of them were non-Jewish. And then we visited Dembitz quite a bit. And in Dembitz, my aunt Rachel was in charge. Actually, her husband, his name I believe was David Reiner, was in charge of the business. And the thing I remember most vividly about that is they had a couple of kids, but one of the kids' name was, all the cousins were, many of us, had the same first name. We were all Solomon, Shlomo in Hebrew, Shlomo Meir. And he was a Shlomo, of course. He was perhaps the brightest kids of all the cousins. And whenever there was a problem to be solved or a riddle, he always solved it first. And I was terribly jealous of him. And I remember vividly whenever we got to Dembitz, there was quite a lot of friction. And we frequently fought, and he wore thick glasses, and I had very little respect for the fact that he was somewhat awkward and ungainly, but an extremely bright boy. In Shendershiv there was my aunt Itala, Ida, whom I was very, very fond of and very close to. And she spent a lot of time with me, and then she met a man called Helman, I don't know his second name, and they were married. And then, of course, she had somewhat less time for me because she was pregnant and began to have her own kids. And I was never very fond of Herman because it was clear to me that he was diverting Itala's attention from me. And she was always there. The head of the business was my uncle Aaron. He was actually there in my mother's family. There were four sisters and two brothers. And he was the younger brother, one of the younger ones, but a very bright man, and acknowledged to be the leader of the business. And I spent a lot of time with him. The thing was always fascinated me that his fiancée, a young woman by the name of Taubi from an adjacent town, would be driven into Shendershiv on a motorbike. And I remember they would put the motorbike up on a stand, and I would then pretend to be riding the bike and tooting the horn. It was very exciting to be on this motorbike. And I never actually was able to ride on it, even, you know, with somebody else, because it was considered too dangerous. But I pretended to, and it was a very exciting time for me. And I really liked Taubi. She was a very lovely and a very bright and vivacious young woman. And they were due to be married, but I don't think they ever were. If they were, it was already after we had left. And my other uncle, the other branch of the business, was in Katowice, and his name was Melech. And I don't have too many memories of him, largely because we didn't visit there very often. I saw him only a few times, and I didn't know that branch of the family as well as the family living in Shendershiv, whom I was closest to. And, of course, the two aunts of my mother's in Berlin, whom I was close to. My father's family I never really knew because his brother emigrated to Israel, I believe, in 1937. His brother's name was Hermann. And I don't have any first-hand memories of him. I have memories of my cousin, but most of those were when we visited Israel afterwards. And we never saw any of the other part of his family. They were dispersed. His parents died when he was quite young, I'd say. I believe none of my grandparents made 50, so I never really knew. And my mother told me that I did meet my maternal grandmother, but I have no memories of that. And I never met, apparently I met my paternal grandfather once, but I have no recollection of that. I must have been a year old.
What language did you speak in your home, and did your family in Poland speak?
Always Yiddish. Yiddish and German were very mixed up in my mind, because in Germany, of course, I spoke German. But the language of our home was Yiddish, and in Poland we also spoke Yiddish, and I spoke Polish quite fluently. And it gradually sort of disappeared for me in China. But I recall vividly when I was in Poland that my mother was always concerned that I'd forget how to speak German because I would chatter away in Yiddish and Polish all the time and spoke it quite fluently. And I guess I have an essentially visually rooted memory, and having learned how to read and write in Polish, I've forgotten most of it. Though when I hear a Polish conversation, it's a strange sort of deja vu experience because I say, oh yes, I recognize words. And I imagine if I were to go to Poland and spend a few months there, I'd probably pick up the language relatively quickly. But I did speak it and simply don't anymore.
Did your father ever join you and your mother during the summers in Poland?
I don't remember him doing that. And I imagine, looking back on it, that that wouldn't have been viable for him because those were his best times. He traveled somewhat during the winter, but very rarely because it simply didn't make sense to go from door to door when there was snow or rain or wind, very cold. People wouldn't open their door gladly for a peddler, whereas in the summer it was very comfortable for him to do so. And those were his busiest, most productive times, most profitable times.
How did it feel to return to Berlin in the fall? Did you look forward to that?
Yeah, I did. The thing I remember vividly about that, now that you mention it, is I remember that there were chestnuts. And we would walk down an avenue and the chestnuts would be falling from the trees and we would take them home and dry them and eat them, and I remember that. And of course, as a matter of, I was vividly looking forward to seeing my father, whom I hadn't seen usually for a couple of months. As I remember it, we were in Poland perhaps 2 months out of every summer. And now whether that was probably July and August, but I'm not sure of that, maybe some part of June. And then we'd return towards the beginning of fall, usually the Jewish holidays, which we always spend in Berlin in the synagogue. And I don't think my father ever came to Shandish. It just didn't make sense for him in terms of his work.
Back in Berlin, aside from the boys waiting for you when you came out of school, were there any other incidences that you experienced of anti-Semitism or attacks?
No, there was the business with the benches that I mentioned, and the attacks by the kids. My most vivid memories of that period were Kristallnacht. I remember that very well. We knew that there would be a Kristallnacht, that there would be activities against the Jews. We didn't know of what kind. And I remember the night before, my mother prepared a bunch of sandwiches. There was a tray of sandwiches which she had prepared. Not really sandwiches. She would make bread with cheese and then lay one on top of the other. And she laid out milk in glasses and water in glasses. And I was told that we would act as if there was no one in the house, that we wouldn't have any lights on in order not to attract any attention. And much of Kristallnacht that I remember through that 24-hour period was spent pretty much in silence. And occasionally you would hear the crashing of glass and noise in the street, and that was always very terrifying. And I recall that my mother discouraged me from going to the bathroom, certainly flushing, because he didn't want to let on that there was any light. There was no light at all. As far as I know, there was no heat, but I can't be sure that. I felt cold. And when we heard the crashing of the glass, that was very frightening because we knew that there was something happening. We didn't know exactly what. And I remember we all wore stockings and we didn't wear any shoes in order not to make any noise. We tried to be as noiseless as possible, and my mother would urge me to eat. And of course, I couldn't eat because I was so frightened. I remember my throat was very dry. And it was one of the times I guess my mother enjoyed, because I couldn't refuse, because I couldn't talk. She put her finger in front of her mouth and say that we couldn't talk. So we would, I'd eat a piece of bread and drink a glass of water, and we spent most of that day in bed in order to make as little noise as possible, waiting for the day to pass. And my most vivid memories are the day after Kristallnacht, when we walked out of the house, and I remember holding my mother's and father's hand on either side. And there was a small grocery store owned by a Jewish family, which was very close to our house. And the first thing we saw is that the windows had been broken, and there was something about Zau Yud, a Jewish pig, written on that. And I remember we walked over to the synagogue, the Rico Strasse synagogue, and I'll never forget that, because the synagogue was in a courtyard, and the courtyard was set back from the street, sort of. So as you walked by, you'd look into the courtyard, and the synagogue was over there. And in the center of this courtyard, there was a mound of simmering ashes. And in the center of the mound were the handles of the Torah. I could see that very clearly. And that was a terrifying moment for me, because I had learned from my Hebrew teacher that when the Torah drops, that you're supposed to fast for 40 days, etc. And I don't know the language in which I said this to myself, but I had the sense that if they could so burn the most sacred objects of our faith, and I remember vividly saying to myself, there's no safety anywhere. And, you know, I saw the Torah was the most vivid thing. I also saw them, there were prayer books which had been burned, etc. But that was a terrifying feeling. I think after that, I was never the same as long as we were in Germany. There was a continual feeling of terror as a result of seeing the Torah. And I guess, fortunately, my father must have felt similarly, because shortly after Kristallnacht, he decided that he would try to leave Berlin. And our situation was, my father had never maintained his Polish citizenship. So he was staatenlos, stateless, and could not get a visa to go anywhere. And so my mother, on the other hand, was a Polish citizen, had kept a Polish passport. And I was added to that passport, even though I was born in Berlin. And it said on the passport, which I have since then lost, it said that until the age of 12, that I would be part of a Polish citizen. So since he couldn't leave anywhere, he and some of his cronies, some people whom he had gone peddling with, hired a smuggler to smuggle them across the border to Belgium. And as we understood it, we didn't hear from them for a few days. And the next thing we heard is we got a postcard from, I remember vividly, the big swastika on it. And the postcard simply informed us that he was a prisoner in Dachau. And then later on, we found out that what had happened is that he had successfully crossed the border into Belgium, and that the Belgian police had picked him up, determined quickly that they were escaping Jews from Germany, and sent them to Dachau. And so the first thing we knew, that he was in Dachau, and he was in Dachau for about 21 days. And the problem then, of course, was that he couldn't get an entry visa anywhere. There was no problem leaving Germany. The problem was being allowed to enter any other country. And I recall quite vividly my mother and I making the rounds of various consulates, trying to find some place for him to go. And that's where we learned that you didn't...
We're going to have to stop now, and we'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. You were telling us about your father being in Dachau.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And as far as we knew then, that we were told that he could leave Dachau if he could find a place to go. And what my mother did, I tagged along with her to wait in some of the waiting rooms, because my recollection was that some of our neighbors or relatives had left. So I went with her some of the time, some of the time I was with neighbors. We tried to find a place that he could go to. And at that point, we learned that you did not need a visa to go to the Japanese-occupied portion of Shanghai, that anybody could go. And my mother then bought a ticket for my father on the Fulda, which was a German steamer. And she went to Dachau. I did not accompany her on that. And the next thing I remember is her bringing my father home. And that was, again, one of the most shocking experiences, because He'd been there only 20 or 21 days, as I recall it. My father was a man who was taller than I am. He was about 6'3". And I always thought of him as a giant of a person. And when he came, I was waiting for them, and I saw them coming through the courtyard. And I mentioned we were in the rear of the courtyard. And I saw that he was limping. He was dragging one of his legs behind him. And he looked much thinner when he came into the house. I recognized that he had shrunk into his clothes. And he suddenly looked as, I don't know whether he lost 20 pounds in that period, maybe more. He'd shaved his head. His hair was very similar and bushy to mine, and hair had been shaven. And he was ashen-faced. And the thing I recall most vividly during the two things I remember, he was with us for about 18 hours, and my mother drove to Bremerhaven with him, or took him on the train where he took the ship, the Fulda, to Shanghai. And the thing I remember most vividly was that he spent a lot of his time with his hands against the tile stove. And he told us that in Dachau, the first thing they had done is they had he had to don prisoners' clothing, striped pajamas, and they had them fall out at before dawn at 5 o'clock in the morning, temperature certainly below freezing, and people were required to run around the courtyard. And he was saying, anybody who fell, you had to step on them. And if you didn't, you were required to lie down and prostrate yourself. So they would run around, presumably for exercise. One of the other things he told me, early on they asked for people who had heart disease to fall out. And they would step forward. When they stepped forward, they had a hose, they were doused with icy water. And many of those folks then, of course, had a heart attack there. And it was a bitter, bitter time. There was very little food. There was no heat in the barracks where they slept. And it was a bitter time. And the other thing that I remember is when my father would come home, as I said before, from his peddling trips, he would always pick me up and put me on his shoulders. After Dachau, I suddenly realized that he had trouble picking me up, because as soon as he'd pick me up, he'd sit down on a chair. And internally, that was terrifying, because I had the image of my father, this giant of a man who would protect me from anyone. And I suddenly realized that he couldn't even protect himself. And it was a very frightening period to see him in such a weakened state. And I really had a great deal of trouble reconciling him with a man whom I thought of as my father. It was a very difficult time for me to see how really wasted he was. And it was a period of only about 3 weeks. And what he said is they essentially had bread and water and some thin gruel for soup. And there were a lot of beatings and a variety of other things. It was a terrible place. Dachau in 38 was a horrible place. It didn't have extermination chambers, but it was a terrible place. And I sort of feel a mental responsibility to go back and look at the place once. And one of these days, I guess I'll have to do that. I have no eagerness to do that, of course.
During these 18 hours that he was home, was he talking openly to you?
Yes.
What had happened?
Yeah. He talked to us about the exercise and the pajamas and how cold it was and how poor the food was, and that it wasn't even an infraction, that the slightest whim, the guards would beat them. They would beat them with clubs and kick them. And it was a very frightening time, of course.
Prior to this homecoming, had your parents talked to you much about what was happening and as to why it was happening or what was happening in Germany?
I never knew why. I understood that the Germans hated Jews. And my impression was that they hated Jews originating, Polish Jews, we considered ourselves more than others. I don't know why I felt that way, but I thought that's the way I felt. And I never understood why they hated them. But I knew, my parents had told me to avoid people in uniform, to wear people with who are Nazi functionaries of various kinds. And of course I avoided the Hitlerjugend, because they were the kids who pursued me in Germany. I never knew why. I guess you would say I don't really know why now either, particularly. But it was just that's the way it was. And they explained to me to try to minimize contact And of course, they minimize occasions where I would call attention to myself in that way. I recall sometimes seeing a parade, a Nazi parade, and being sort of impressed by all the finery in military uniforms and then shying away. Because internally I knew they were the enemy because they were out to do me in. Why, I don't know. I never knew. It just had been made clear to me that they hated Jews and that we needed to avoid them as much as we possibly could.
Do you know if prior to this your parents had thought about leaving?
Yes, my parents had thought about going to the United States. They had applied for visas to the United States in 1935. And they had family here who gave them an affidavit, which at that time was needed to indicate that they would assume financial responsibility for my folks. But since my parents were born in Poland, the quota system then in place made it impossible for them to emigrate. And the consulate estimated it would take them something like 10 years for their number to arrive to come to the United States. And that was the only active attempt they made. Now, there was often some talk about going to Poland, but my father felt that he couldn't make a living there, that he had established a routine of villages that they would visit, and when he would go to visit, the farmers would be expecting him. And it strikes me in retrospect, it was kind of surprising because my father looked as Jewish as I do, and I'm a very Jewish-looking person, of course, that that was not a disadvantage to him, but obviously it wasn't because he made a good living. It wasn't a luxurious living, but we never wanted for food or clothing or shelter or anything like that. And as I said, I had all the toys I wanted. So he did well at that, and he felt he couldn't do as well in Poland. And that's why we stayed. If the opportunity had arisen, we would certainly have come to the United States.
Was your father home with you and your mother on Kristallnacht?
Yes. Kristallnacht, of course, was November, and then he did very little traveling during that time. The three of us were home together, and the feeling was, I think there was some feeling maybe we should join the other relatives, the Blaufelds, who were my mother's sister and her family, or the Jaffes, but the feeling was that it was probably best to be separate. Because in case one family was in danger, the others would be safe. There was some feeling about that. And I also remember, speaking about safety, etc., that my uncle Philip Jaffe, Fivel we called him, was, I guess he got a summons for an interview with the Gestapo. And I remember the family meeting. The interview was for a Monday. And I remember we met all that weekend. I remember the adults were in one room. And the kids, my cousins and I, were in the other room. We knew that important things were happening. We didn't quite know what. And at the end of the meeting, I know we kissed the Jaffes, and everyone hugged one another. And my parents didn't tell me what was happening till we went back to our house. But what had been decided is that the Jaffes would simply leave everything in place and leave. So that Sunday morning, my uncle and aunt and two kids acted as if they're going for a walk. And they had pretty much the clothing on their back and whatever valuables they could put in whatever you take for a walk. They went to the train and went to Poland and left everything in the store. The store was left completely intact because the fear was that we had heard that people who went for such appointments at the Gestapo often didn't return, and it was decided that they should leave because who knows what would happen as a result of the summons. And I know that my father was tempted to go into the store that Sunday afternoon and clear out some of the most valuable textiles and clothing. And my mother was terribly upset about it and frightened about it, and she prevailed upon him not to do so. Now, I think he actually did go into the store, but he didn't take anything. Or if he took something, were very minor things, because my mother was terrified that the store might be watched, that he would be found out, and that the family would be in danger. And subsequently, of course, it turned out that the Jaffes did the right thing because they did survive by escaping and leaving everything in place.
Where did they go at that point?
They went to Shendishev. They got on the train, they walked, they got on the streetcar, as if, as I said, they were going for a Sunday outing, took the streetcar to the train station, took the train station to Poland. And then what happened to them is, I don't know why the rest of the family didn't do that, but as the war broke out, they ran towards the Russian lines. And they made it to the Russian lines, and the Russians interned them and sent them to a work camp in Siberia, where they survived during the war. That Siggy and Max Jaffe and Malcha and Fire were their parents. And we heard that they had survived, I think it was in 45, 46. And the only other member of the family to have survived was Salo Blaufeld, whose parents lived in Berlin. Salo was my cousin. His mother's name was, I'm blocking on that. Sala was her name. I guess Sarah was her real, but Sala was what we called her. And her husband's name was Isaac, and his sister was Puppa. What happened, Salo tells me that in Shendyshev, the Nazis walked in on the first day of Rosh Hashanah in 39, and they cleared out all the men, put them in trucks, put them in the forest, and they were all shot. And Salo, who at that time was probably 13, was a very able-bodied guy, and he was selected to go to a work camp. And he's alive and lives in Washington. He survived seven work camps, and I've never seen this other than with Salo. He didn't have a number tattooed. He had KL, which is German for Konzentrationslager, on his hand. And apparently he was interned before they started the process of stenciling a number. And he made it through seven work camps and survived. All the rest of the family were gassed. Most of them in Bergen-Belsen, we understand. Those who survived were sent to Bergen-Belsen from Shendyshev. And most of the family gathered in Shendyshev at that time. And none of them survived. And none of my father's family survived beyond the brother in Israel. None at all. Perhaps a total of something like over 25 people.
Do you recall, at the time you received the postcard that your father was in Dachau, had you, as a young child, heard of concentration camps? Did you know what it was?
Not really. We had heard that there were camps, but knew nothing about it until my father returned. That's when we heard in detail. But we knew something about the fact that people disappeared after these interviews, which is why my Uncle Philip and the family decided to leave. But specifically where they were or what, I mean, I know about it now. I don't think I knew anything about it firsthand then. The first-hand knowledge we had was when my father came home from Dachau, and of course when he was interned in Dachau. The thing I remember is there was a card which was completely pre-printed, and and typed in was my father's name, Moses Winschlauch at the time, of course, that he was held at Dachau. And the other thing I remember is that the canceling stamp on postcards at that time always had a big swastika on, and this had a big swastika on. It was a very frightening time.
At the time you were taking your father to begin his journey to Shanghai, what were
I
your ideas as to where he was going?
I had no idea. As a matter of fact, I didn't accompany my mother. My mother took him to take the ship in wherever it was. I don't know with whom I stayed at the time. I would get, you know, I had no idea what Shanghai was all about. I didn't know where it was, China, etc. In retrospect, of course, I realized what a courageous thing it was for my parents to do, because China was, you know, out of our, you know, no one ever had. I don't know whether my parents ever knew the word Shanghai until they heard about it. But I had no idea beyond the fact that the people there were different, that they were Asian, and I heard that they were yellow and that they were short. And that's about all I knew about Shanghai. And what my parents told me is the Jews were safe there, and that's why he was going, and that there would be no Nazis and that there was safety. And that's pretty much all I knew about Shanghai at the time. I know in Shanghai we read a book by Vicky Baum. It's about the Shanghai, something about Shanghai, where Shanghai figured very prominently. But then we were already there. I don't think we read that before.
What was your mother's planning once she got your father out? What were you and your mother going to do?
My mother and I were going to follow him. As I explained, my mother had a valid Polish passport, so for her to leave Berlin was relatively easy. And we didn't want to leave. We didn't need to leave everything the way the Jaffes did. So the idea was that my father would go to Shanghai, and as soon as he had a place to live, that we would go. And the thing I recall is we gave up the apartment and whatever possessions we had, we either sold them or gave them away. And I know we stayed in a rooming house for one or two nights in Berlin. The thing that was another very frightening experience, because I was suddenly in a strange place. By this point, all our relatives had left, and all our friends, like the Atamans, were gone, because I believe they went to Shanghai shortly after my father, maybe a few months later. And my mother and I left Berlin in late May, early June 1939. And the thing I remember is she had to do some last-minute arranging of things, and we were in this, I guess it was a rent-furnished room. And the thing I recall vividly, when she had to go and arrange something, she told me that they were Venetian blinds, not to open them, not to call any attention to myself in this room, and that she'd only be gone for about an hour or so, then she'd be back. And the thing that I remember vividly is I suddenly heard the noises of a parade. There was a band sound. Of course, as a kid, I was very curious, and I walked to the window and opened one of the shutters of the Venetian blinds to look at the parade. And I saw the parade was passing, and there were trucks and the band, and then an officer in a big car, I guess a Mercedes in retrospect, was standing there making the Nazi salute heil. And it happened, as luck would have it, at that moment, he looked towards the window where I was looking out. And I was terrified that I had been seen. I remember vividly after that, dashing into bed and pulling the covers off the bed over my head and waiting until I only heard muffled sounds, and I assumed the parade had gone had ended. And when I tucked my head out of the bed, I saw on the ceiling above the bed, I saw the hats of the Nazi uniforms walking along the ceiling. And it was an absolutely terrifying experience. And I ducked under the bed again. I don't know how long I was there. And then gradually, when I came out, there was nothing there. I don't know whether I realized then or whether I realized this later that what must have happened is there must have been another vehicle in the parade. And the reflections of the people marching were projected onto the ceiling in the room. But I know it was a terrifying moment for me to see these disembodied heads marching along the ceiling and knowing and being frightened that I had been found out. And of course, it was an irrational fear. It was one of them, that and some of the other experiences I talked about, were some of the most frightening memories I have of that time. And when my mother came home, I told her about it, and she calmed me down. And within a day of that, we took the train to Genoa. And in Genoa, we went on to, spent the night in Genoa. And then we took the Conte Bianca Mano, which was an Italian ship of the Loitria-Stino line. We took that to Shanghai. Two things I remember about the train trip is that there were lots of interrogation, control. You know, the train would stop, and there'd be an officer walking through and asking for papers. And my mother would show this passport with me on it. And the thing that I remember vividly is that I sat in the corner, in the compartment, in the corner of a seat, and the officer who was doing the interrogation, controller, call it, would sort of ask me to come forward into the light and grab my face to look at me and I guess to compare what I looked like to the picture. And generally he'd say, alles in Ordnung. And at that point I would be relieved. And I know after he left, my mother picked me up and I could feel her heart beating probably as loudly as mine. And you could hear them walking through the train and they seemed to rip the doors open. And it was a very frightening experience. And the next thing I remember is, well, you must have crossed the border, because now the inspections were in a different language. There was no alles in Ordnung. It was not, well, obviously it was Italian. I didn't recognize it. But the language seemed softer and less frightening. And the thing I remember vividly is when we stepped onto the Conte Bianca Mano, there was, I guess he was the first lieutenant or something in the ship. Two officers of the ship were waiting. And my mother showed her her passport and her tickets, and they actually bowed. That was such a different sense of what had happened to us in Germany. And then they motioned the steward over, who spoke German, who led us to our cabin, and who offered to do unpacking for us, etc. And I also remember that the little cabin we had seemed relatively luxurious. I remember a sparkling pitcher of water, and there's some fruit on it, and the steward, but you know, the ships, they couldn't feed us enough. And I had trouble coordinating that with the terror we'd experienced in Berlin. And my mother explained to me that she had to buy first-class tickets because all the tourist tickets were gone. And that waiting for tourist tickets might have meant another few months, and she just wanted to get out of Germany as quickly as possible. So she bought the best tickets we can, and so we had a relatively luxurious cabin. And I remember there was so much food, and it was such a pleasant trip. And my mother kept urging, of course, we were kosher at the time, so we ate almost nothing which was heated, but there were lots of fruits and breads and pastry and salads. And no matter how much I ate, I never ate enough to please my mother, because she kept saying, eat, eat. And then she'd always say, you know, who knows what's going to wait for us in China, and who knows when the next regular meal we would get. And I remember that as a very pleasant time, the trip. And I actually got a suntan. And the only, I remember, it's not a fear, but the only feeling I had is I was worried about who would meet us in Shanghai, whether it was my father or a man whom I had grown used to not thinking of my father as the man who had returned from Dachau. Because there were different people in my mind, really. And I was concerned about that. But frankly, there was a swimming pool, and there were a lot of things to do in the ship. And those were two of the most pleasant weeks that we spent. And I remember we went through the Suez Canal around India, spent a few hours in Bombay, a few hours in Calcutta, Hong Kong, and then we got to Shanghai.
Did you disembark at all in these
Yes,
ports?
Briefly. Very briefly. I remember, the thing I also remember is little boats of traders coming towards the ship selling various things, and then Asian kids jumping, and you know, you would throw a coin and they would dive for it and pick it up. And I remember that with great excitement.
Do you recall what you personally were able to take with you on a trip? Any of your toys or any of your personal possessions?
No, I think we took virtually no toys, but we took several trunks of most of our clothing. We took no furniture. I don't remember any things like dishes or anything like that. I just don't remember. But I do know that we must have had three or four very large suitcases, and I think something like a steamer trunk. Because since my mother was of Polish origin, she had no trouble shipping things out. We were traveling legally. And so we took a lot of clothing with us, and I think that's about it. I don't think we took anything else.
You didn't take anything that meant something to you personally?
There are a couple of prayer books. I don't remember anything else, though, of personal nature. I imagine, you know, the toys were kind of bulky, and it's not the kind of thing which would fit into a suitcase. So I know we didn't take many of those.
Were there any other children on board the ship?
There must have been, but I really don't have any memory of that. I was very preoccupied with happy to be away and sort of at the same time worried about China. I had no real sense for what that would be like. There would be different people. I knew there'd be different language. I knew they'd look different. And how I would fit in and what our place would be. And of course, what shape was my father in. Now, we had heard from him, of course. He had written to us, and we saw pictures that he had on the. He took the German ship, did not go through the Suez Canal. It went around Africa. So it actually took him 4 to 5 weeks to make the journey from Germany to Shanghai. And he had written to us that during this 4 to 5 weeks that he also was very well cared for and fed on the ship, that even though it was a German ship, he said that typically the crew acted very correctly to the passengers, that he was not subject to any of the anti-Semitism and discrimination we had experienced in Germany. And he said that he gained a considerable amount of weight from the pictures we had seen, that he actually looked like he had gained some weight and he looked more like himself. What was always troubling to me is in the pictures, of course, his hair was still the hair of the prisoner. They shaved all his hair off. And in my mind, even though he looked more like himself, it was as if he was still returning from Dachau. And that's one of the things I was concerned about. You know, what would he look like 6 months later? We saw he was in Shanghai for about 6 months before we joined him. And he wrote that we would have a place to stay, that he arranged we'd have a room, and he was waiting for us. And that was reassuring. But I really wasn't reassured until I actually saw it. I remember the last night before we were to, you know, we were in Hong Kong and the next stop was Shanghai. And I had a great deal of difficulty sleeping and was tossing and turning all that night. And wanted to go up board deck to see whether we could see Shanghai. My mother reassured me that he couldn't. But eventually, towards dawn, I simply couldn't stay in bed any longer. We got up and I ran up on the deck. And of course, I couldn't see anything. We were supposed to dock. I imagine it was 10 or 11 o'clock. And my mother insisted again for the thousandth time that we have a good breakfast, because who knows what would be waiting for us in Shanghai. And then I stood on the deck, and as the ship got closer to the dock, we saw lots of people waiting. There were other refugees. There were other refugees on the ship as well. And I remember vividly being able to pick my father out, and the one thing I looked for was his hair. And he looked like he used to look in these 6 months that he had. And that was very reassuring to see him. And it was fairly easy to pick him out because, as a taller person, he towered over many of the Chinese around him, and he was also taller than many of the refugees. And that was reassuring to see him. And as the ship docked, I remember the first thing which was wonderful for me is that my father picked me up on the shoulders the way he had before, and the way he couldn't when he returned from Dhaka. And after that, I felt better about being in Shanghai. I felt more reassured. And of course, we all hugged one another for a few minutes. Nothing much was happening. And then my father sort of took charge and told us, this would be where the luggage were. And then for the first time, I saw rickshaws. I'd never seen rickshaws before. And he indicated that these rickshaw coolies would pull us to where we'd be living.
Were there any official procedures upon disembarking?
None that I recall. I remember seeing Japanese officers. They seemed to be officers. They were uniform. I also saw the dock. As we left the dock, I saw a Japanese sentry with a gun. My mother pointed out that these were Japanese and that they were different from the Chinese. But there were no procedures that I was aware of. Now, we had a passport ready. It would have been no difficulty, but visas were simply not required. And so there were no formal procedures, and my father hired four rickshaws. And it's amazing how you communicated, because he had we call it pidgin English, you know, a few words of English, a few words of Chinese, a few words of German. But he was able to communicate to them, and I know my mother and I were in one rickshaw. He was in we were in the front. He was in the rickshaw on the rear, and there were two rickshaws for our trunks. And in this procession, we made our way to the first house we lived in Shanghai, which was at 737 Broadway. We were in house 8, I believe, of the lane. Now, a lane is very much like an interior courtyard. You might imagine there might be 20 houses, and there would be a center road, and then there were houses coming, little smaller alleys, and there were houses off these alleys. And much of Shanghai had lanes like that.
We'll have to stop now. We'll continue on the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number 3. Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. We were talking about your arrival in Shanghai, and you were describing the lane on which you lived.
Yeah. And much of Shanghai, not all, but much of Shanghai is arranged in lanes like that. The area in Shanghai we lived in is called Hongqiu, which is one of the poorest sections of Shanghai. And the lane where we lived happened to be fairly close to the dock on Broadway. And in this house, my father made his living in Shanghai. In Shanghai, you can't, at least at that time, you couldn't buy a house. I guess it must be true, too. But he was the chief tenant in the house. He leased the house from this corporation. And the house had 7 or 8 rooms, I don't recall which, and basically every family rented another room. And so he was the major tenant. The Ottomans, who were our neighbors in Berlin, were also co-owners of this house, meaning co-major tenants. And we rented rooms to other refugees. When we pulled up to the house, I really had no idea where we would, what it would be like, and my father arranged for the coolies to put the trunks up, etc., and then he asked me, as I remember, to wait outside to make sure that none of them would be stolen. And he took my mother up. We were on the second floor of this house, and then he took me up. My first recollection is that it was a room somewhat smaller than this living room, a little smaller than this living room. this was going to be our home. And I remember thinking how much smaller it was than our apartment was in Berlin. Now we were all in one room. And in many ways, it seemed much less luxurious even than the cabin we had had on the Canta Biancamano on our ship. And I remember that there was there were windows sort of towards the left coming in on the front. And on the right-hand side, there was a sofa, and my father pointed out the couch, you know, that I would be sleeping on that. Next to that, there was a... Shanghai doesn't... at least our apartments, our rooms, didn't have closets. So there was a big wardrobe. And he said, there's a big wardrobe. And my parents' bed was in the rear. Then, sort of walking towards the front, there was a table with four chairs and an icebox. And that was the whole apartment. And I remember thinking to ourselves, to me, that how much poorer off we were than we had been in Berlin. Of course, I didn't say anything about that. There was a common kitchen. As you walked out of this room, there were other rooms like that. And ended up, ours was one of the larger rooms. We and the Ottomans, as the major tenants, had the largest rooms in the houses. All the other rooms were somewhat smaller. When you came up on the second floor, came up the stairs, there was a four-burner gas stove and one sink, only cold water. There was no hot water anywhere. And that was the kitchen that was being shared by the four families on the second floor. There was another similar kitchen on the first floor shared by the four families there. Towards the rear, there had been a room which obviously had been very recently built, and there were two water toilets in it. And what my father told us, I don't know what he told me then, but when it became clear that we were fortunate, we had water closets then. Much of Shanghai, there were no water toilets. And later on, when we moved to someplace else, I'll talk about that, we moved to places which didn't have any. And I remember thinking to myself that it would be difficult living in these environments. And as I said, it was clear to me that we were worse off. And then my father told us that there were places where other refugees had come, and they were called Heime. Heime were group homes. And in the group homes, there might be 20 people to a room, and they were living in double-decker bunks. You know, there was a bunk above that. And the only separation for privacy, people strung up ropes and hung blankets or clothing in order to have some privacy. And when I saw some of those Heime, the first one I saw, I believe, was the Shaofeng Road Heime, and there was another one called the Ward Road Heime, and I suddenly realized that compared to the Heime, we were really very well off. And it became clear to me that this would be a more difficult life. But at least we were together, and it was also clear that there were no Germans. And while I saw Japanese in arms, the sentries had guns, etc., they essentially ignored us, which was very pleasant. I mean, we had very little to do with them. They were obviously in charge. Now, the way Shanghai worked at that time was that Shanghai was a tripartite city. One part had the same status as Hong Kong used to have, had been leased to the British for 99 years. That was called the International Settlement. And that was the more elegant part of Shanghai. Next to that was the French section of Shanghai, and the French had a similar lease obtained from the Chinese for 99 years. And in that area, all the street names were French. There was Avenue Joffre, and I'll talk about those later. And the British part, of course, they were all British. And as a matter of fact, in Hong Kong, many of the streets had British names, like Broadway. Hong Kong had been the part of Shanghai that the Chinese had retained. And the Japanese had occupied the Shanghai in 1937. There was a fierce war, and we saw the remnants of that. I mean, there were houses which had clearly been bombed. And as we went from the dock to our house, the rickshaw coolie would run by places, and it was clear that the house had stood there, and the only thing remaining was one wall. There were many like that. And there were many there was rubble where it was clear that there had been houses which had been destroyed. My father explained that there had been fighting there, and that the Japanese had won and occupied Shanghai, but he made it clear to me that they really had nothing against the Jews. But it was also clear that they were treating the Chinese very, very badly, and I saw lots of evidence of that throughout. But I think for the first few days, the newness of being in China was just overwhelming. Shanghai has temperatures in the summer of 90s, a routine. I mean, near 90, 100. It's an extremely human being. Shanghai is a great natural harbor, being only a few blocks away from it. I remember vividly that my father explained to me that we pulled sofas and all furniture a bit away from the walls because the walls were literally wet from the humidity. It was so intense. And I guess they didn't have oil-based paints because my father told me not to touch the wall when it was wet, because when you did, you left a palm print, and the paint would come off on your hand, and you could see then for a long time that that was that. And this was always true in Shanghai. Lots and lots of humidity. It was very, very hot, hotter than anything I'd gotten used to. And we spent all our time wearing shorts and T-shirts and I guess sneakers. And of course, there was no air conditioning, there was no fan, there was no telephones or anything like that. And you simply had to make do with the heat. A lot of everyone had one of these paper fans, and you fanned yourself with it a lot. Lots of bugs, flies, mosquitoes, various insects of various kinds, lots and lots of cockroaches. People would for fly catching, they'd have these, there were sticky strips of paper which you pull out of, it looks like a film canister, which would hang from the ceiling, so when a fly would alight on it, it would stick on it and it couldn't leave. You could never have that in the small room that we had because you're afraid that you'd get stuck on it. But that was pretty much the only thing that people would do, and you would have fly swatters. And I spent quite a bit of time trying to catch flies and got to be fairly skillful at trying to catch them because they were all over the place. And there wasn't much sanitation. We had a central garbage dump. We dumped the garbage and it would be emptied a couple of days a week. And they would come and empty that. And it was clear that life in Shanghai was very, very difficult, more difficult for the Chinese than it was for us. I remember one day, it was very, very hot in the summer, perhaps a month or two or three after I had arrived in Shanghai, and my parents, typically what we would do, we try to take a nap in the middle of the day between 12 and 2 and 3 because it was impossibly hot. There was nothing very much to do. I remember it would get so hot that the tar on the pavement would get soft. Not all of it, but some of which had been in the sun, and you'd have a truck going by, you'd see the marks of the truck on the pavement. And I remember one day, I couldn't sleep, so I walked out, and in the front of our lane, a rickshaw coolie was ostensibly sort of taking a nap in his rickshaw in the shade. And I remember he was being hailed by a Chinese woman. He didn't respond, and she walked over to him and sort of pushed him with her foot, and he fell over, and I suddenly realized he died. And I ran home to my father and told him what had happened. And he said, yeah, that sometimes happens, and that there's nothing we could do about that, because what happened in Shanghai is that if you reported a death, that you would have to pay for the pickup of the corpse. And for the next two or three days, the rickshaw disappeared, I don't know where, but the coolie lay there, the corpse lay there. And flies were buzzing around him, and the smell was awful. And then he was picked up in due course. Now, it would be a lie to say this happened every day. It did not. But it was not an infrequent occurrence. I must have seen a couple of dozen people like that who had died. Sometimes, I remember, you'd see them in these courtyards strewn with rubble where Chinese men would relieve themselves some frequency. And I remember once or twice a man, after relieving himself, had actually passed away and was lying there for days before he was found. The other vivid sort of memory, the rickshaw coolies had a very hard life. Imagine the temperatures in the 90s and 100s. These people were pulling other people. They were acting like horses, basically. They would run between the shafts of the rickshaw, and the rickshaw had a seat, not unlike this, a comfortable upholstered seat with two huge wheels, and was propelled by this man running along. And I noticed, even coming from the ship to our house, that within minutes his body was glistening with perspiration, and most of the rickshaw coolies would run. They would have the Chinese pants which they rolled up above their knees, and they would have bare chested. And within minutes, of course, there would be rivers of sweat, and they would be running into his pants. So pretty soon you'd see that the pants were all wet. But despite that, there were, that's how they made their living. There were lots and lots of people like that. And it was clear that this was obviously a very difficult life. The other thing I saw on the trip from the ship to the our lane was there were sort of street kitchens. There would be a cart somewhat bigger than the rickshaw, and there would be people cooking on it, and there'd be one bench on one side, the cook would be on the other side, and there would be street kitchens, and a lot of the Chinese were eating at them. The other thing which became very clear, living close to the dock, we had to cross two rivers in order to get to the international settlement. There was a small creek and there was a larger creek, the Suzhou Creek, and the Suzhou Creek was the border between the Japanese-occupied part of Shanghai and the international settlement. And on that, I remember early in our stay, we walked over to the Suzhou Creek. One of the things I saw, which was really shocking to me, was that there were kids who were working on the junks are basically huge wooden boats which were used to transport goods. And families would make their living doing that. But they also lived on them. You'd see kettles where they did some charcoal kettle where they did cooking, etc. And men were openly relieving themselves into the water of the Suzhou Creek. And on the other side where men were relieving themselves, you'd see women lowering a bucket for water, which they would then cook with, which made my parents point out to me most vividly that it was unsafe to drink the water because water came from there. And I was told never ever to drink water which had not been boiled, because some refugees had, and they were incredible. You know, there's a lot of cholera, a lot of typhoid, a lot of TB, various illnesses. And I was told never ever to do that, and of course I didn't. It was quite a vivid impression to see that. And I remember also seeing, I mean, the hard work of the Chinese physical laborers was something I had never seen before. Not only the rickshaw coolies, but the way some of the junks were propelled when there was no wind, they had sails, is that they would lower huge bamboo poles. Obviously, the smaller creek was not too deep. So they'd lower these poles until they hit ground, and then they'd push against them. And as they would walk the length of the boat was propelled forward. And you could see the rivers of sweat running down their face. And they would always have some, it sounded like a dirge, but there'd be some kind of sing-song. There'd be one man on one side, one man on the other side. And this is how they would propel the junks. And the intensity of that labor was really incredible. And also seeing the primitive conditions in which they lived, because the junks were how they made their living. That's where they lived. The family would live, and there would be a little sort of tent-like affair at one end of the junk, where there'd be, I guess, a little table and stove, and that's where people ate. And it was clear that this is a very hard time for them. It was also clear that the Japanese treated the Chinese with great brutality. I remember on this first day when my father took us on a walk to, it was perhaps a 15, 20-minute walk to the border of the British settlement. In the center of the bridge is called the Garden Bridge, which separated the Japanese section from the British section. There was a Japanese sentry in a hut with a rifle with fixed bayonet. He was on sentry duty. Now, for some reason or another, I don't understand what happened. I know that Chinese man had displeased him there. He was talking to him. The next thing I knew, the German took the butt of his rifle and smacked the Chinese guy in the head with it. The guy fell and started to breathe and crawled away. I know in my mind's eye, even though I knew he was Chinese, the man was Chinese and this guy was Japanese, in my mind's eye, I saw the highly polished boots of the Nazis in Germany. And I was very, very frightened. My father picked me up. He recognized this right away and said, you know, that the Japanese were very, very brutal to the Chinese. But they really had nothing against us at all. But I was very reluctant to cross the bridge at that point after that. So we went to another bridge and we crossed over to the international settlement. When you got into the settlement, it was very different. The settlement had much more elegant houses. There were apartments. All the houses in Shanghai that I had seen in Hankyu were generally two stories. There was, I think, one street which had three-story buildings. As soon as you walked into the settlement, you saw multi-story buildings. They obviously had elevators. There were elegant stores. The Bund is well known, huge buildings of banks. The Chase Bank had a big office on Nanking Road, corner, I've forgotten what. And you realized you were in a it seemed as if you were in a European environment. And people living in international settlement were, of course, were very much better off. Now, our ship docked in Hankyu, so we had no trouble disembarking. When a ship with refugees from Europe came and docked in the French or the British section, that was an entirely different story. In order to disembark there, you needed papers, much the way you would have in order to go to Britain and France. And of course, if you had those papers, you wouldn't come to Shanghai to begin with. Now, what often happened is that the refugees were not permitted to disembark. So what they would do is they would hire one of these junks that I talked about, which would row them up the river to Hankyu, and then you get off in Hankyu and be among us. In some occasions, the British put these people, the refugees who arrived, into trucks and drove them across the Garden Bridge to Shanghai. A few refugees managed to settle in the settlement. Now, my parents told me that they were very well-to-do and therefore had the money to do that. And they had, from what we understood, I was never in one until after the war, but that they had apartments like we had in Europe. They were elevators, and it was running hot and cold water, and there were stoves, etc. As far as I could tell, this was summer, and we'll get to that when we get to the winter. We had no means of heating our room, and that was, of course, a problem. And the British and the French parts were very elegant sections of Shanghai. And it was clear, you know, we couldn't afford to live there, and very few people could, but the British and Americans who were in Shanghai, and there were some lived there, and there were some French. And there were two groups of Jews other than the refugees who were helpful to us, who had been in Shanghai before. And there was a Russian Jewish community that had settled in Shanghai as the result after the Revolutionary War in Russia. The Bielorussians, the White Russians, had ran away from the Reds, from the Bolsheviks. And many of those made their way to China. There were three reasonably large Russian communities in China then, in Harbin, in Tsingtao, and in Shanghai. And the chief rabbi of Shanghai, a man by the name of Rabbi Ashkenazi, was a Russian Jew. And the Russian Jewish community was supportive of our community. There was another group of Jews who were Iraqi Jews, interestingly enough. One of the leading hotels on the Bund was the Sassoon Hotel, I remember, and they had their own synagogue, in the settlement, the Sephardic Jews. And they had a Sephardic synagogue there, and they were also very helpful to us. There was a man called Kaduri, Horace Kaduri, and we heard when I arrived in Shanghai, it was of course summer, there was no school, and we heard that Mr. Kaduri had donated the funds to build a school. And among the refugees, we called it the Kaduri School. The formal name for it was the Shanghai Jewish Youth Association School, a jawbreaker of a title, of course. And that was the school which was being built when I arrived in Shanghai, and that's where my parents pointed out to me that's why I would go to school as soon as it was built. We walked over and saw the building of it. And so Mr. Kaduri donated the money for that, and they were helpful in terms. I think what was happening is that they helped set up the Haim. Both the Russian and the Sephardic Jews were helpful to the refugees to some degree in helping us. And also, I think there was some funds coming through the American Jewish Joint Distribution Committee, which helped those folks who were without any means in the Haim. The people in Haim essentially all ate in a group kitchen, etc., because there was no way they could provide for themselves. And this Jewish community, with which we had virtually no contact, but we knew they were there, and they were helpful. And the British, of course, the Iraqi Jews, Sephardic Jews, were British. So they had no concern about the Germans at that point. This was still before the war, or the Japanese for that matter. And I don't know what the nationality, frankly, of the Russian Jews was. I don't know whether they had Soviet citizens. I don't think they did, because I remember after the war that the Soviet Union tried to entice many of them to come back to the Soviet Union. But not being identified as German refugees, they had the prestigious status, and many of them, you know, they were active in trade and in business and had shops of one kind or another. And generally, that community was quite well off. Interestingly enough, the Russians, when they had first come to Shanghai, had also lived in Hankyu because it was the poorest part of town, the easiest part to find accommodations. And the synagogue to which my father belonged was called the Ohel Moshe, Tent of Moses Synagogue. And the only remaining Russian Jew was the president, the man by the name of Mr. Ovadia. And all the other, he was the last remnant of that community who had lived in Hankyu. As we were told that the Russian community was going to close that synagogue, they were building a new synagogue in Rue de la Tour in the French section, which was called the New Synagogue, strangely enough. And they were going to abandon the Ohel Moshe until refugees started to arrive from Europe. And then when refugees arrived, they needed the synagogue. The synagogue was on Ward Road, which was very close to a prison, which I'll talk about in a minute, and its president, Mr. Ovadia. We also had a Hebrew school there on the top floors of the synagogue. There was our Hebrew school. Of course, I went to Hebrew school. The other notable thing about Shanghai, in addition to the fact that it's a great harbor, Shanghai has one of the great jails in the world. And this jail took up something like 8 to 10 blocks on Ward Road and was sort of catty-cornered across the street from the synagogue. And you could walk around and say, I mean, these were some of the mightiest buildings in Hankyu. They're actually multi-story buildings, 3 and 4 stories. They appeared to be very secure buildings, and we all know that was a very big jail. One of the haima, the Wartime haima, was right across the street from the jail. On the other side of the jail, sort of directly across a rubble-strewn courtyard, was a market where my mother did most of the marketing. The market had basically stands, you know, stands selling vegetables and fruits and meat, and there were 3 or 4 refugees who'd opened stands who were selling kosher meat. And there was a Rabbi Ashkenazi, there was obviously a shochet, a ritual slaughterer, so there was kosher meat available. And my mother would do her marketing, and I often accompanied her going to the market over there. And in Hankyu, a street called Chusan Road became sort of the center of refugee life. It was fairly close to the Ohel Moshe synagogue. And there were many Jewish businesses in it. There were people, I recall there was a butcher in addition to the butcher in the market. And there was a store where you bought milk goods, milchik and fleishik, of course. And there were 2 or 3 cafes, European-style cafes, where the refugees had opened on Chusan Road. And you know, in a European-style cafe, you walk in, you have a cup of coffee, and you sit there with the rest of the day reading the newspapers, etc. And there were some refugees who were somewhat better off who could afford to do that, and they would do that. So Chusan Road very quickly became the center of refugee life over there. And much of the life for me began to revolve around what was happening in the lanes and what was happening in the school. The lanes were really very exciting places for a kid like me from a city like Berlin because in addition to living there, there was a lot of life going on. It was peopled by peddlers. Virtually every day you'd have people walking through, and it was cute to have the Chinese pick up a few words of German. And there were men who were repairing shoes, and they'd walk through the lane yelling, Schuhmacher, it's about the only foreign word they knew. And most of the dealing with the Chinese, of course, was is that you bring out the shoe, you show what needed to do, and then you'd start to bargain. Now, bargaining was something which was not unique to me. My father, having been a peddler, was used to bargaining, and of course, European Jews from Eastern Europe are used to bargaining. Most of the Jews in Shanghai, and the Jews, I should mention, kept streaming in. The estimates were that we must have had a community of around 15,000 to 16,000 Jews. And most of the Jews were German Jews, and they were utterly unused to bargaining. And I know as Polish Jews, we made fun of them. We called them Yekis, you know, German Jews are Yekis, which is presumably coming from Yaket. And they would always pay what they were asked, and we thought that was ridiculous. And my father was pretty good at bargaining. I learned about bargaining pretty rapidly. And I can't quite tell you how we communicated, but we managed with signs, with fingers, with this and that.
Was everyone that was living along this lane all refugees, or were there still Chinese?
There were even some Japanese as well. There were some Chinese living in each of the lane and some Japanese living in the lane. And we didn't have a great deal to do with them. As a kid, the most amazing thing to me was that Chinese women nursed their children quite openly. And I had never seen a woman's breast before. And as a young boy of 6, 7, this was obviously a great source of fascination to me. And when my mother saw me staring at a nursing woman, she always told me that it was wrong to look. And of course, I learned pretty quickly that the safest time to look at women nursing babies was when my mother wasn't around, because she would try to draw my attention away one way or the other, quite unsuccessfully, I might admit. But this was quite amazing to me that this would happen. And it was also several other things which were amazing, which were not recognized among the Chinese. The Chinese had toilet buckets in their rooms. They didn't use a common toilet, and they were buckets, and these buckets would be emptied at night and would be picked up. And even in houses in our lane, the 730 lane had running water closets. But even there, some of the Chinese used their own toilets. I had a great deal of difficulty getting used to that. And of course, people eating with chopsticks, the way the Chinese were. This was something I hadn't been used to at all. That was very surprising to me. And in many of the stores, Chinese stores, which you saw that some of the clerks would actually live in the store. When the store was closed, generally late at night, they pulled down some mattresses from, they sort of had a storage compartment in the upper half of the store. And they pulled those down and make beds, and they'd sleep then, and they'd eat, and the next morning tuck all that stuff away and go into business, and they'd be doing business. This was a lot of that. The other bits, being on Broadway being very close to the docks, was a street of many bars. Now, a bar in Shanghai meant something different than it does in the United States. In a bar, there were bar women who would entertain sailors. And what I heard was that these women would be dancing with the sailors, etc., and you would see them dressed very gaudily, and they would entice sailors to come in, and there'd usually be a two- or three-piece band. Otherwise, they'd have a gramophone and a radio, etc. And it became pretty clear to me and other kids, and we shared information, what was happening is that the ladies in the bars made their living basically by when the sailor would buy a drink, they would have colored water, and the sailor would be charged for a regular drink, and they'd get a cut of that. And then also it became clear that the ladies would disappear with the sailors, and that they were being paid for other favors, which we were very clear about. And you can understand that the boys speculated with some curiosity what was happening, where and when. And we had a bar right outside our lane, so we generally managed at night when people... I should explain that what happened in Shanghai, a lot of social life occurred at night because temperatures were so extremely hot that people would pull out chairs and sit in the street, either in the lane or actually out on the road, in order to catch a breeze until 11, 12 o'clock at night. The houses had virtually no insulation, so after the heat of the day, after the sun went down, it's as if the house was an oven and would have picked up the heat of the day, and it was impossible to sleep in that kind of weather. And we wouldn't go to bed till 11, 12 o'clock at night when the houses had sort of cooled down. And in the meantime, we'd be sitting outside, our parents would be talking, the kids would be playing one thing or another. And we generally managed to try to play the kinds of games which would permit one of us to run to the bar to pick up a ball or a marble, etc., and peek into what was going on.
We're going to have to stop. We'll continue on the next tape.
All right.
Tape number 4. Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. You were describing playing so that your ball would roll toward the bar.
Yeah, well, the bars were generally, sometimes the bars would have white Russian women as bar girls, and there were a few gypsies who were bar girls, and mainly Chinese. And they were always, as I said, very gaudily and seductively dressed. With Chinese women wear this tunic, which is sort of, which has a split, and generally goes sort of around the knee. Well, obviously, the bar girls would split, would be somewhat higher up, and it would be very taunting and very exciting. And we try to see what the hell is happening in the bar over there. And generally, the most we ever saw was some very, reasonably heavy petting, etc., and some, very close dancing. We never saw anything else. But we did see that the sailors and the women who were most heavily engaged would disappear somewhere. And we had a reasonably good idea what they were disappearing to. Also, not far from our house, being close to the dock, I remember there was a street which I never quite understood exactly what was going on at first. I figured it out pretty quickly. And that in those shops, there only seemed to be women, and I didn't know what was going on. They were obviously the houses of ill repute, and the Japanese sailors would, as other sailors would frequent them, there were some streets which had only bordellos on them. I mean, mainly, and there might be a few other stores, perhaps a quarter of a mile away from our house, half a mile, something like that. So we got used pretty early to the fact that there were prostitutes and there were bar girls, and the bar girls seemed to be like one cut above the prostitutes. And we also got used to the fact that the Japanese were very brutal with the Chinese women. And not only did they frequent the bar girls, one vivid memory I have of a Chinese lady. Now, I haven't mentioned Chinese women traditionally, older women, had their feet bound when they were little girls. So you would see an adult woman whose foot would be this big because it was considered beautiful or ugly for a woman to have large feet. So they were tied up, and these women obviously had some difficulty walking. They had some difficulty maintaining balance, and they would sort of hobble. And I remember a Japanese, he appeared to be an officer, and who had obviously was drunk, and he accosted a Chinese woman and was talking with her, I was shocked to see that he grabbed between her legs, and she pointed in the direction of where the street of houses of ill repute were, and the officer sort of walked on, and she took, I remember vividly, something out of her pocket and wiped her brow and sort of hobbled off. And I was thinking to myself, what a terrible life that was for the Chinese who were, I guess it must have seemed to me, I must have realized that the Chinese must have felt in Shanghai the way I felt in Berlin, that there was nothing they could do, that they were helpless. And I felt happy that the Japanese essentially ignored us. And that was a source of, of satisfaction that they left us. We didn't quite know why they left us alone, but they left us alone entirely. And as I said, the Chinese were not so lucky and had a very difficult life.
Did any of the Jewish refugee women have to resort to making a living?
Eventually, not in the bar next to our lane, but we heard that there were refugee women who were working in some of the bars. And later on, there were refugee women who actually were working in some of the bordellos. And then later in the war, that was a very unpleasant experience. My father knew a man who had also been a peddler in Germany. And these people had come, let's say there was the parents, and they had brought their daughter and grandson along. And for reasons that I don't remember, the husband of the woman had not accompanied them. And one day we visited them. This was perhaps 3-4 years later, and I remember we visited them. And they were somewhat better off than the rest of us because they had a multi-room apartment as opposed to the single rooms. We couldn't quite figure out the sources of their money. And as we were visiting them, having tea, it may have been a Saturday afternoon, I don't remember, and I was playing with this kid out in the street. We saw a Japanese official drive up in a little truck, and he parked the truck and he came in. And the younger woman, the mother of this kid, meaning the daughter of the people my father knew, excused herself and disappeared with the Japanese man. At that point, I was playing with a kid outside, and I asked him what was going on, and he said, oh, he's my mother's friend. And then he said, she has lots of friends. And within minutes of that, my parents came striding out, picked me up, and said I was never to play with that kid again. So it was perfectly clear what was happening. This was a lady who was a prostitute who was plying her trade in her house. There were other women from the Heim who were doing that as well, but not in their house. They typically worked in the bar. There was one barmaid who was living in our house. I'll describe her name as Irma, which was not her real name. And she was the daughter of one of the people living in our house, and she was obviously the only means of support. And some nights she came home late, and some nights she didn't come home at all. And so there were some of that, but that was a minority. The majority of the women in the bars were either Russian, obviously the majority were Chinese, and there was a small minority who were either Russian and some gypsies. And, of course, then, as I said, a few of the refugees women joined them as well.
Now, in your house that your father was renting out, was everyone a Jewish refugee?
Yes. Yes.
And was your father responsible for maintaining the house as well as renting it?
Yes. Well, I don't have any, I don't have a real recall for what maintenance meant. I don't remember ever things being painted, you see, but there must have been. So he must have been responsible for that. And we lived there from June 39 until, I guess, 42 or so. That's the other, we began to hear of things beginning to happen. I remember things changed a little bit, of course, with the outbreak of the war. I haven't talked about the school yet. Let me talk a little bit about the school. The Shanghai Jewish Youth Association School. Kaduri School was. We had largely refugee teachers. There were a few young Russian Jewish women who were also teachers, And the school was a very nicely arranged school. The structure was such that it was as if it was a big U. And there were classrooms running down either side of the U. In the center, there was an assembly hall, a kitchen, I think a library. And some of the upper grades were in close to the center of the school. And in the center there, there was an area where we did our calisthenics and played soccer. And there was a grass a lawn, essentially. We played our soccer over there. And I remember starting there. And I did very badly in school. I was not a good student at all. My parents were really very worried about me. And I simply couldn't get the hang of it. It was very, very difficult for me to learn how to write. I didn't have much difficulty learning how to read. The language of instruction was English, and the refugees who taught there spoke English, and the white Russian women spoke English, and the principal was a lady by the name of Mrs. Hartwig, who was a teacher in German, and we were all very frightened of her. She was rather strict. Authoritarian sort of a lady, and nobody wanted to get in her bad graces. Not that anything bad ever happened, but we had a lot of respect for her and a lot of fear for her. And I remember vividly coming home and being kind of proud to show my mother the first sentence I had written. And it sort of began on one line and ended at three lines further down. And she said, "Oh, is that the worst you can do?" And I remember being so disappointed because I was very proud of that. And I just couldn't get the hang of it. I also found that my mind was always wandering. I have some ideas about why it is now, but my mind would always wander. And I knew I had difficulty with some of the arithmetic and with other things. I found the instruction boring in many ways. For example, the teachers would spend long hours doing grammar. In grammar, you had to, what's the predicate, what's the subject, and they went into this in some detail, I guess in the belief that it would improve your English, which of course it didn't. And it was dreadfully boring, and they also had a big deal about memorizing spelling of words, and I could never really take to that. And when it came to tests, I very often found myself really blocking on what was going on, and I couldn't understand, and I did very poorly. My parents arranged for me to have some tutoring. And what was puzzling to them, and not to me, but was puzzling to them is, on the other hand, typically I'd be in school until around, let's say, 9 to 2 or 3. Then I'd walk home, and then we'd walk to the Talmud Torah, the Hebrew school, which was on top of the old Moshe synagogue. And there I was an exceedingly good student. And I was really considered one of the really bright kids in this group. And it was a real puzzle to my mother. And she always said to me, if I did so well there, why couldn't I pay more attention? And we went through this. And nothing helped particularly because I guess reconstructing it, as I think about this, that the school must have had something to do with my memories of the school in Germany, etc. And my mind must have been wandering because I imagine I had a great deal of anxiety. And subsequently, having been something of a scholar in the area of anxiety, and perhaps 30% or 40% of my research now has dealt with test anxiety. And it never really occurred to me why I was studying test anxiety until I began to think about my experiences in Shanghai, and then it became rather clear why I'm supposedly something of an expert in test anxiety, though frankly I don't do anxiety reduction treatments. I'm a basic researcher in the field of anxiety. But in any event, somehow or other, the fact that in the Talmud Torah we were studying stuff which had not been associated with fear for me, because it was the same kind of instruction I had. I had people coming to the house and prayers, and I was Jewish, and we were studying in a group. And the other thing is, motorically, I'm still not a very skillful person motorically. I'm somewhat awkward motorically. And in the Talmud Torah, we never had to write. It was just a matter of reading and understanding. And it became clear to the teachers that I could understand this stuff pretty well and figure out what was going on. And it seemed to me that in the Kaduri school, we didn't have to do a lot of figuring out other than in math. And math was just something I could never really understand terribly well. Math anxiety, I guess, thinking about it now. I was doing very badly in that kind of school. And I remember my parents had always felt that I was really pretty capable. But as I began to get poor grades, grades in the low C's, etc., I think my, and they arranged for tutoring, etc., I think my mother began to fear that perhaps I was not very able, maybe I was just a very slow student. And none of the tutoring she arranged for me improved my performance in the Kaduri school. And I don't think they ever understood, nor did I ever understand, why I did relatively well in the Hebrew school, but it became clear that I did well at that. I read Hebrew fluently, I knew all the prayers by heart very rapidly. And when we studied in Talmud Torah, we studied the Chumash, the five books of Moses, with the preliminary commentary on that. What was fascinating about that is the Chumash is written in one kind of print, and underneath that is Rashi, the commentator on the Chumash, which is a different kind of print and somewhat smaller and more difficult to decipher. Well, I picked that up pretty quickly, and I was able to read Rashi and I read the Chumash, and I understood and began to understand the implications of various things and all the figuring out, and that went pretty well. And I never made it in the Kaduri school, and was pretty clear. My best subject in the Kaduri school was Hebrew. We had one class in modern Hebrew, strangely enough. There was geography and algebra, which I was a
companion. How were the kids treating you in the Kaduri school, since you weren't doing too well?
I don't know. I don't have too many memories of that. I have memories of playing soccer and being a fullback, and I never had the grace to be in the center or on the front, and I did that pretty well. I was good at endurance, things like running, but no one really talked to me about being stupid. What the kids teased me about terribly was the fact that my head was crooked to the age of around 14 or so. Apparently in birth what had happened is that there was a muscle which was strong and my head was sort of pulled slightly to the side. And I was always called Chief Cup, and that was a bitter pill to swallow. And of course, if I could, if the kids were my size or I feel I could beat them up, I would fight. And if they were obviously too big and I got beaten up, I simply had to suffer it in silence, and I was very unhappy about that. Thinking back on it, maybe that was one of the reasons I was unhappy in the Kaduri school, because no one ever called me Chief Cup in the Talmud Torah. That was something which simply didn't come up. My head was crooked, that was that. Whereas, maybe it had to do with the fact that in the Talmud Torah there weren't any girls. And of course, in the Kaduri school, there were girls. Now, whether the Sheaf Cup began with girls or not, I don't remember. But I do know that when kids wanted to tease me, it was very easy to call me Sheaf Cup, and I would be livid with rage and anger and unhappiness and depression. And on the point of tears, of course. This didn't happen all the time, of course, but, you know, kids can be cruel from time to time, and I had a fair amount of that.
In school and also in home, were you getting much news from Europe, from the world?
Yeah, there were two major sources of news. The refugees published a newspaper called the Shanghai Jewish Chronicle, published by Ossi Levine, who was the editor. And my recollection, this was anywhere from an 8 to a 4-page newspaper, and we got most of the news about that. In addition to that, the Ottomans, who were the co-major tenants, and let me mention the other house in a minute, please remind me. They were tailors. Mr. Ottoman was a skilled tailor, and his son really worked with him. And they had a radio. They were the only people that I remember in Alain had a radio. And of course, Shanghai being as warm as it is, there was a German language broadcast 2 or 3 times a day. And most of our news about what was happening would come from the Shanghai Jewish Chronicle, and from the radio broadcast 2 or 3 times a day would broadcast the news of the day. And that's how we heard about the war having broken out in Europe. And I can't say that I was very concerned about it, but I know that my parents were always worried about that, because as they heard about the war with Poland, etc., they were wondering about what happened to their family. And of course, there was no mail. And an undertone of concern about among the older folks, among my parents, was what was happening to the family in Europe. Nobody knew. We heard nothing except that the advance, victorious advance of the German army, etc., etc. We heard a lot about that. There was also a German language non-Jewish paper called Ostasiatischer Lloyd, East Asian Lloyd. And I don't remember whether that was a daily or a weekly, because the German community in Shanghai was relatively small. It was there, but a smaller community than the Russians and the others that I mentioned. And those were our sources. And we heard about the war in Europe, and there was much worry about the advance. On the other hand, I felt sheltered by the fact that the Japanese weren't picking on us and the Chinese weren't picking on us, and we traded with the Chinese. And it's too strong to say that they welcomed us, but they left us alone, and that was more than had happened to us in Europe, so we felt pretty good about that.
Was your father able to make an adequate living with this building?
It was a small living. What he also did, I guess my mother must have brought some of our funds from Germany with her, because afterwards he became major tenant at another house on Seward Road, which was a block away from where we lived on Broadway, where he was also a partner in a house. And we were very worried about the fact that as the war began, the number of refugees arriving had slowed down to a trickle. The people who arrived after the war essentially had come across the Soviet Union to Manchuria, Vladivostok, Vladivostok to Dairen, from Dairen they took a Japanese steamer to Shanghai, but there were very few of them. And we had perhaps, I think, three or four rooms vacant in the house on Seward Road, and we were very worried about that because it was a major investment in my parents to become the major tenants, and they didn't have any tenants, and three rooms were vacant, and so that was a drain. The other thing my father did is he resumed being a peddler, but in a different way than in Germany, instead of traveling. Many German refugees who had not been well advised, what they did is they packed all their belongings in Germany into a huge crate. We call them a lift. Lift is basically almost a crate, perhaps a quarter the size of a room, where they packed all their belongings, including furniture and cooking utensils and heavy clothing, etc. These lifts became a terrible drain for people because they didn't have the room to, most people, some, the ones who lived in the settlement, of course, could unpack, but in Hankyu, no one could unpack a lift. And they had to pay storage for these lifts, because once the lift was taken off the ship in these huge cranes, they were standing there and storage had to be paid. So people very quickly decided to sell the remains of their lifts. And my father opened a stand on Kung Ping Road, where basically what he did is he had bought stuff from the refugees and sold it to the Japanese and Chinese, the belongings. And some of the things you'd see would be pretty ridiculous, and then I remember, well, actually it was later on in the war, seeing a rickshaw coolie running along, pulling a rickshaw along with a derby hat. Now obviously it's a hat he bought from one of the stands on Kung Ping Road, as refugees were trying to sell their stuff in order to liquidate the lifts and also to make a living. And so he did that. This is how he made a living. We were never well off in Shanghai, but on the other hand, pre-war, we were never wanting for food either. We lived, obviously, very modest, in poor circumstances. But before the war, I never remember being hungry. And the food was adequate. And we went to the synagogue regularly, and that was much of our life, going to the synagogue, and there was the Kaduri school, there was all the stuff going on in the lane, there was the Schumacher and the vegetable guys. It was also exciting, of course, the guys selling ice would walk through the lane. They'd have huge, you know, they'd have a huge cake of ice, and you'd come by and you'd want a piece of ice for your small ice box, and they would chip it off, and they had a little hand scale, they'd weigh it, and you'd bargain about the cost of it, of course. And that's how we kept out whatever little food we had. And there were kids selling ice, and I was told never to eat that ice because we didn't know what kind of water had been used for making it. So I never. There was only one ice which was considered safe, which was made by a British firm whose name I've forgotten. But we never bought from the tradesmen who were traveling through. And there were watermelons being sold, and in the winter one of the things which was a great delicacy was basically sweet potatoes. But what they did is they would take a big tin, an oil drum, that's what it was, an oil drum. And imagine an oil drum, what they would do is the bottom half was left as it was, and the top half, they had clay, and in the bottom they would put charcoals, and the charcoals would heat the top half, there'd be a grate, and potatoes would be stored over there until they'd be liquid, and it was really very delicious and was very inexpensive. We even had some of that during the war. They'd sell these potatoes in the winter, and you would you'd split them. You could, and they were almost liquid. Of course, they were very hot. It was very delicious to have a sweet hot potato, and that was on sale regularly. And that's about the only Chinese food we actually bought. We distrusted all the others. because of the various diseases. My parents told me we could never eat any fresh fruit. Instead of that, there was always compote, which is boiled fruit. Every once in a while, we'd have a banana, which was considered safe because it had thick skin, or an orange. Apples were strictly forbidden, as were grapes. But they were available, they were forbidden, because from time to time, people came down with typhoid and cholera, and of course, most of those people died. It was very difficult to deal with those sorts of diseases. But I don't know, I'm sorry. I've forgotten the question you asked me. I was wondering.
Well, speaking of people who died, was there a Jewish hospital there?
Oh, yes. We had a small Jewish hospital in the Hankyu and the Ward Rodheim. There was a Jewish hospital. There was also a larger Jewish hospital in the French section of town that's interesting. I remember the Chinese name Fen Yangle, what it was. There was Rupershaw, the hospital. And when you get to that, I eventually was hospitalized there. And that was a hospital which had been built by the French and by the Russian and the Sephardic communities. So there was that hospital. And most of the refugees, when they were sick, went to the hospital in Hankyu, in the Ward Rodheim. And there were perhaps a dozen or so physicians from Austria and from Germany who treated the Jewish community. And they were affiliated with the hospital, of course. And I can't talk about the quality of the hospital at this stage, but there were doctors and there was a hospital. And I must say, given this is a community, you know, of refugees, that there was quite an interesting cultural life. And we had a newspaper and there were theater groups. I was too young for that. I remember there were meetings about the school, and I have a picture of one when the parents met, like the parents and the kids, a meeting about the school. And there were cultural clubs of one kind or another, and there was a very active social life, and kind of an enterprising community when you consider people having moved to a totally foreign environment from Europe. And as I said, most of the Jews were German, smaller minority of Austrians, and then there were East European Jews, such as my parents. And there were some, and in the lanes, mainly, of course, also German Jews, my parents became very friendly with some other people, the Lerbels. Mr. Lerbel, who was a shirt maker, and therefore he made his living making as a shirt maker in his one-room apartment. And Ziggy Lerbel and I became best friends, and his father shared an East European background with my parents, so we became very close friends. And his mother had been born in Vienna. And then there were other kids, but most of my friends were the friends I made in the Talmud Torah. These are the kids I hung around with. Some of them ended up in New York. Ziggy Lerbel is here, and Norbert Zeiden is here, and a few of the others. And some, of course, are not. And those were the kids, they were my reference group, and those are the kids I hung around with. And when I would do things outside of school and outside of the cheder, it was invariably with the kids either living in the lane or with the kids from the Talmud Torah. And of course, Ziggy Lerbel moved into our lane, so we were pretty much inseparable for most of the time.
You mentioned your father had these three empty rooms.
Yeah.
What happened with those rooms?
Well, after the outbreak of the war, this was pretty exciting. I'm going to talk a little bit about the outbreak of the war. We knew a war had broken out because suddenly in the middle of the night, there were huge explosions. And the refugees gathered, and we thought they were bombing, but it's a very funny explosions because at first you hear a huge explosion, and then you'd hear a sound of something, and then another explosion. Pretty soon the adults figured out that shells were being exchanged.
Are you talking about in 1941?
41, December 7, 1941. What happened is there was an American ship and a British ship in the harbor there, and the Japanese shelled them and sunk both ships. And that's how we found out that the war had broken out. The next morning, the German newspaper announced, and the radio announced proudly, that the Japanese had ended the war on the side of the Axis, and that the great victory was anticipated, and the great victory at Pearl Harbor, etc. The refugees, since there was very little to do, we were sitting outside at night in the summer, there was a lot of speculation about what things meant. And I got used to hearing political discussions pretty early. Most of the refugees felt that this alliance could not last very long because they couldn't see the Germans being allied with an Asian people for very long. And we figured sooner or later that this alliance would break up, etc. And then there was the problem was, would the Japanese continue to treat us as well as they had? Now that they were allies of the Germans, there was a lot of fear. because it was clear that they would be interacting with one another and that this was probably not terribly good for us. And a lot of concern about what that would mean. And so when the war broke out, the first thing we found out when life had changed is the Japanese decided that for reasons that obscure to me, maybe they expected an invasion, that the refugees would be a sort of a, I guess, an auxiliary police called the Pao Chia, and the men took turns guarding the lane at night. The gates to the lane were locked, and they wore this armband with the Pao Chia, and they were given a club, and we thought it was pretty amusing. Our parents didn't think it was so amusing, but we didn't know what was going on particularly. So that was first the Pao Chia. Next thing we began to notice was that fuel was getting scarce. Shanghai never had a great many cars, but cars were very free. Well, cars were getting scarce. And then it became clear that the Japanese were having real problems because pretty soon we began to see that instead of gasoline, they changed the fuel on some of the cars, that the cars would actually go on gas. And since our lane had regular gas, what they did is they would develop a sort of a structure above the car, which was filled up with gas, and the car would then run on this fuel. And in order to get a refill, one of these cars would basically pull up to a place where there was a pipeline of gas. They would open it and refuel, and that was pretty exciting the first few times it happened. And we were told to, you know, to shoo away because the gas was potentially lethal or damaging, etc. And then later on, we actually noticed that the Japanese were developing some cars which would run on charcoal. They had a charcoal stove, which was fueled, and these cars never ran very well. They ran fitfully, and they started. So it became clear to us that gasoline was a problem during the war and that there were going to be concerns about that. About that time, when we thought that no more refugees would be coming, about 1,200 refugees arrived from Kobe. And this was a very unusual group. This was the last group of refugees to arrive from Shanghai. Among those 1,200, 900 were an intact yeshiva. They were called the Mir Yeshiva, which was well known for its scholarly study of the Talmud. And they arrived in Shanghai, I think it was in late 41 or 42. And
we'll have to stop okay. Now. We'll continue on the next tape.
All right.
Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. You were talking about the arrival of the Mir Yeshiva.
And the first we heard about it, we heard that the synagogue used by the Sephardic Jews, Beit Aharon, had been converted as a dorm for the yeshiva, for the Mir Yeshiva. I'd never heard of the Mir Yeshiva before. And my father and I walked over to that, to the Beit Aharon, and we saw these very pale, wan-looking guys, yeshiva bochim. They were all, even though they spoke Yiddish, and we spoke to them in Yiddish, they were monosyllabic. I guess they must have been shocked to suddenly find themselves in Shanghai, and we heard that they had been moved or transferred from Kobe, where they had landed. And their story briefly is that they ran from Mir, which is the town, as I said, of where the yeshiva, well known for its scholarly pursuit of the Talmud, to Kovno, now called Kaunas in Lithuania. And that's where they settled. They ran from the Germans in Kaunas. And then when it began to appear that the Germans would be appearing in Kaunas, they were trying to get out, and they couldn't figure out where to go. A Dutch student went to the Dutch consul in Kovno. Actually, this was a Dutch businessman who also had the office of the consul, because there's nobody else there. And the consul gave him a stamp to indicate that he could travel to Curaçao, which at that time was a Dutch possession. Being a Dutch citizen, there was nothing unusual about that. But of course, in order to get to Curaçao, that meant he could get out of Kovno and across the Soviet Union to Vladivostok, from Vladivostok to Kobe. When the rest of the yeshiva found out about that, they went to, the next step is most important. With that certificate, he went to Mr. Sugihara, who was the Japanese consul in Kovno. The Japanese consul issued a transit visa so that he could go to Japan in order to get to Curaçao. As soon as the rest of the yeshiva found out about this, they also went to Sugihara. And Sugihara also gave them transit visas. Now, Sugihara knew full well that these people couldn't go anywhere. They were not Dutch citizens, and that they couldn't go to Curaçao. And it was a heroic act on Sugihara's part, who basically saved 1,200 people by doing this. Now, I have learned since then that the British government cautioned the Japanese government not to permit this, that they would be saddled with Jews, they wouldn't know what to do with that. And Sugihara was asked to discontinue doing this by his government, and he simply disobeyed his government and single-handedly was responsible for saving the life of 1,200 lives of maybe 1,200 people. And it's a great pleasure for me to know that Sugihara is honored with Wallenberg and the others in Yad Vashem. But that's how the yeshiva made it to Shanghai. And for me, it was very exciting seeing these guys suddenly, and we didn't know what was happening. And now what happened is that the mashkiach, who was sort of the spiritual supervisor of the yeshiva, rented one of the rooms in my father's other house. And his son-in-law rented the other room and another son-in-law. So there were three or four vacant rooms, and they were all suddenly occupied. And that was a great pleasure to us. And of course, the yeshiva decided, where are they going to find quarters? And so they looked for quarters. There was 900 people. And they looked for quarters in Hankyu. And eventually, they bought two houses, some of the only three-story houses in Hankyu, the two adjoining houses. And there was reconstruction, so they had a great main hall. This is going to be the yeshiva. But until then, they hung around my father's synagogue a lot, the Ohel Moshe synagogue, because they didn't know what else to do. And my father's synagogue was, all of the members were East European, so they felt very much at home. And we got used to seeing yeshiva guys. After prayers, they would sit around and they would do their studying from the Talmud.
Now, these yeshiva guys, how old were they?
They were typically in their 20s. They ranged from their 20s to around their 40s. Now, the senior people may have been in their 50s. The mashkiach seemed to Reb Chesko, who was a very honored and sacred man, was in his 50s or so.
Now, were there any women and children with this group?
A few, but in a great minority. Of the 900 or so, there may have been 40 or 50 women, the wives of some of the older students and senior scholars of the yeshiva, but they were very, very few. And there were also a few other Jews who were not religious, and there were a few Hasidim who also came with this group. There was a small detachment of Lubavitchers who were in Shanghai, and they got themselves a small place on Tongshan Road, as I recall. No, the Lublinas were in Tongshan Road. There were also Lublina Hasidim who came from Lublin, and they were Hasidim, you know, mystics as opposed to the others. And we ended up spending a lot of time with them. And Hasidim, of course, wore the long sideburns and the beards and the frocks, the kapotas with the tzitzis sticking out. This was pretty familiar to me. I'd seen this in Poland all the time. There was even a rabbi who had become detached from his yeshiva, a rebbe, not a rabbi, the amshin of a rebbe, who was, you know, a sacred figure, who somehow had become detached from his followers. And he was in Shanghai as well with this group. And pretty soon, as the Mir Yeshiva Bochum started to hang around our synagogue, one of the things they would do is they would ask you, well, what are you studying in the Talmud Torah? And I remember vividly one day, a couple of yeshiva bobs started to ask me what I was studying. And then pretty soon I found there were five or six guys standing around me. And they started asking me, I remember this so well, it was very funny. They started asking me questions about what I was studying. And I answered, I was having a good time. And their questions got to be more detailed. And I dealt with those. And then the questions got to be more speculative. And what I was doing, I remember vividly, I began to make inferences. I said, well, if this is so, this is so, and this was so, and it got more and more detailed. I remember this was a great, really for me, it was a wonderful day. And pretty soon I was stumped. I mean, the questions were so difficult, I really couldn't cope with them. And one of the most respected students in the yeshiva, that I remember, he had the reputation that he studied every night until 4 or 5 in the morning. His hands were stained yellow from nicotine because he was like a furnace at night. And pretty soon, as the questions got more and more detailed, and I simply said, you know, I don't know. He turned to some of the people who asked these questions and said, you know, that's not fair. You would have trouble dealing with that question. How could you ask him? And for the first time in my life, word spread among the people in the yeshiva that I was pretty smart. And this was an absolute revelation to me because I had not, you know, given my experience at SJYA, I never thought of myself as being particularly able. But I suddenly realized, hey, I was pretty good at this stuff. And what began to happen is a lot of the yeshiva bochim, as long as they hung around the Old Moshe Synagogue, would seek me out to do a page or two of the, this or to give me assistance in one way or another. And they would seek me out to offer to help. And they began to suggest the possibility that perhaps what I should do is study full-time in the yeshiva. And I liked that idea because here I wasn't being considered stupid and no one was considering me a yeshivka. And I was actually considered pretty smart. And I mentioned this idea to my parents and they were furious. And there was an enormous amount of disagreement, etc. Because obviously you needed to, my parents wanted me to have a Jewish education, but they also wanted me to have a secular education. And so they disagreed. They wouldn't hear of it. This was an argument to be repeated many times, and because the Yeshiva Bochum kept suggesting this to me, and ultimately, as we get to it, we'll talk about that, I did join the Yeshiva as a result of those experiences. And then what happened is, shortly after the outbreak of the war, in 42 or so, a proclamation was issued by the Japanese that all the Jews had to live in a certain circumscribed part of town, in Hankyu, a small section of Hankyu. And of course, we immediately called it a ghetto. And it became clear to us that we had to move into the ghetto. And suddenly, the houses inside the ghetto were much more valuable than the houses outside because we were forced to move in. And it became pretty clear that the only way to find accommodations was to trade houses. But since you couldn't arrange a trade, so you had to pay something called key money, first time I heard that term. And we went, my father and Mr. Ataman, and my father and Mr. Neufeld, went looking for houses so we to move into the ghetto. The big problem we had is we found a house on Wayside Road, which we ultimately moved into, which seemed pretty acceptable. The problem, of course, was that, you know, no one had the same room that they had, and people had smaller rooms, larger rooms, and my father talked to the tenants and said he couldn't afford the key money on his own. Everybody would have to chip in to pay some of the key money because we had to pay to go into this section of town. The biggest problem with that house was there were no water toilets. One room was set aside, and we had two buckets in there. And these buckets were emptied at 4 o'clock in the morning. Coolies would come by, and they'd empty it into a wheelbarrow. And, of course, the stench from the waste would be in the lane for hours long afterwards. And people took turns. And this week was your turn to let the coolie in. Next week it's your turn. And that's pretty well how we managed. We moved into the ghetto somewhat before the deadline. And then a terrible thing began to happen. We noticed that some people had decided to ignore the Japanese order to move into the ghetto.
Well, how long had they given you? What period of time did you have?
My recollection is that it was 3 months, 3 or 4 months. I may be wrong.
And this was early in 42?
That's correct. That's my recollection. The historian, whom I'll refer to later on, has done some research on this, and I could get the exact dates, but that's my recollection. And some people would not turn in the ghetto, and they were sort of flaunting, and they were getting away with it. And we began to worry about whether we had traded in a nice house for a much poorer one in a poorer area, etc. And then suddenly, one fine day, all the Jews who had not moved into the ghetto were picked up by the Japanese and jailed. And that was a grim time because they didn't stay in jail very long. The jails were infested with lice. And pretty soon, my recollection is there were about 12 people or so who were jailed. And within a week to 10 days, they all came down with typhoid. And they went into the Ward Road Hospital. And I think with one exception, they all died because we had no medication at that point to deal with that. And then we suddenly realized that it had been wise to move into the ghetto, A and B, that our time of being treated gently by the Japanese was over, and that this, we were now interned. The ghetto was unusual because they didn't need walls. See, in Shanghai, the way it worked is the British and the Americans had been taken to internment camps, and we saw them walking around Shanghai with red armbands, saying that they were with a Union Jack or the Stars and Stripes on them. And then they disappeared, and we realized they'd gone into camps, as did the French. Then if you saw a European face in Shanghai, if it wasn't German or Russian, it had to be one of the refugees. So the Japanese didn't have to build any walls or anything. They just said, you got to live in this part of town, which was away from the harbor, and that's where we lived. And in order to leave the ghetto, you needed a pass. And the passes were issued in three denominations, daily, weekly, and monthly. And there was a Japanese official by the name of Goya, Mr. Goya, a short man, who was paranoid, but a sort of benign paranoid, and he issued the passes. In general, he was fair, but he was nice to older people and to kids. He was relatively brutal to people who came to him. There was a story making the rounds of Hankyu that a woman had come to him asking for a pass to go to her to work in an office as a secretary, and she was wearing a bare midriff. It was 110 or something. He asked her why she was wearing that, and she said, "It's so hot." And he says, "Oh, you're warm." And he took a bucket of water and pounced it on her. So while Goya didn't kill anybody, as far as we knew, he was very brutal to some people. And I said he was paranoid because the rumor made its way around the ghetto that he took violin lessons from an Austrian Jew. And this man had a picture of Napoleon in his house. And Goya, supposed to have looked up at Napoleon, and said, "Oh, that was a great man, but I'm a greater one. I'm the emperor of the Jews." Fortunately, he, outside of these occasional fits of temper, there was no other violence that we could see. He actually did attend some of the soccer games and ran up and down the sidelines with an air of sort of authority, somebody who knew about the game. And my parents told me whenever you saw him to try to avoid him and try to avoid eye contact, because the less trouble, the better. But outside of these minor things, there seemed to be no major concerns. But going outside of the ghetto was simply forbidden. And that's when what began to happen is, as people died, they were buried in cemeteries. There was the Baikal Road Cemetery, where people from our synagogue were buried, was Orthodox Jews from Eastern Europe. And it ended up that Mr. Neufeld, who was the partner of my parents in the other house, who also had to move into Hankyu, died. And outside of next of kin, you couldn't go visit the cemetery. Now, it happened that kids were permitted to go outside of the ghetto boundaries. And I remember attending many funerals of people that I knew, sort of in lieu of my parents, because they couldn't go, and these were people they wanted to go. Now, they were very leery about me going, but I had no hesitation about that, even though I recall, even years later, having some troubling dreams, as if I was still wandering around the cemetery. But it became part of life, and that was that. We ended up populating three cemeteries, the Baikal Road Cemetery, and the German Jews had two other cemeteries, and they were more Reform and conservative rather than Orthodox. And when I returned to China subsequently, I found out that something really unusual had happened, is that during the Cultural Revolution, the cemeteries had all been destroyed, and that they built factories on top of them. And the Chinese were very embarrassed by that, because they also revere the prior generations in the past.
Did you have a burial society?
Yeah, the burial society. There were people who were members of the burial society who cleaned the bodies and all of that. This is something I only knew about a little bit, but there was a burial society of people in the synagogue who washed the corpses of people. My most vivid memory of that is as a kid called Lothar, this is before I entered the yeshiva, who was in the Kaduri school with me. And he must have caught spinal meningitis, because we knew that he was out of school for 3 days, and by the third day he was dead. He had very, very high temperatures. This was very scary to everybody, of course. And the thing that I remember is he had lent me something, and I had it of his, and I was very embarrassed because I didn't quite know what to do with that. And we were all very frightened of catching something, because as the war wore on, we had more difficulties with medication, of course, and there was very little medication that you had to treat people with. And as the war continued, food became a very real problem, of course. And I remember that more people went to the Heime. The Heime developed emergency kitchens where people would go and either eat there, or they would bring food home in sort of a series of nested pots where there would be soup on the bottom and that little bit of meat and then vegetables, and they'd bring them home to eat. What was puzzling to us was that the people in the yeshiva were eating very well. And it became clear to us, and rumors were circulating, that they were getting money from sources that we didn't know about. This was also the period when the yeshiva had built its own building on Wayside Road, and the inducement for me to join the yeshiva got to be greater and greater, because I got to be known as a better and better student there, and I certainly didn't improve in the Kaduri school. And I talked to my parents again and again and again. Finally, in late 42 or early 43, they agreed, and I discontinued studying at the Kaduri school and studied in the yeshiva full-time. And shortly thereafter, I induced Sigurd Label to do the same thing, a bunch of other kids. And we were given some financial support by the yeshiva. We got the equivalent of something like $5 American a month. $5 American a month was easily enough to feed the family. I mean, we didn't eat well, but we were able to, the things that I remember us having were big pots of rice and buckwheats and something called hirza, which is the equivalent of some kind of grilled bird food. And then my mother would cook that up with a piece of meat and fat, and that would be a big meal, and that would be bread. Butter was very rare, and milk was very rare. My parents would buy half a quarter of butter, and then they would insist that I wouldn't eat it because I needed it to grow, and it was always very embarrassing to me because they wouldn't eat it, but they insisted that I eat it because it was important for me to grow. For me to eat the butter and for them not to have it was awkward, but that's one of the things I did. There were also another kind of fat which ultimately resulted, of course, in my parents developing coronary disease. Most of the fat we used was chicken fat and beef fat. That would be if you take the fat, then you would boil it out of the fat, and we'd have that on our sandwiches, etc. Low cholesterol food. So we had a lot of that.
Did you ever get any food at the yeshiva?
Not usually. Usually I walked home for lunch and for breakfast and dinner. The time we ate at the yeshiva was on high holidays. On holidays, usually what would happen is we would have cake in the break between the morning prayer and the afternoon prayer. So you couldn't eat bread because bread is considered a formal meal, and after that you'd have to say benchen and et cetera, whereas cake was not. So very often in the middle you'd do that, and you might also have some wine or some soda or something in the middle of the day. But pretty soon what began to happen is it was very unusual. Here I was in Shanghai, and I was living the life of a small shtetl yeshiva bochum. I'd go to the yeshiva at 8 o'clock in the morning, and I'd come home for a quick lunch, which was a 10-minute walk, and I'd walk back to the yeshiva. I'd be there until late at night. We would all meet all the kids who were called the yeshiva katana, the small yeshiva, who would get formal instruction for about an hour and a half. Rabbi Finkelstein would sort of do a lecture on a page or two of the Talmud. And then we would discuss it. And the big goal was to be able to read the Talmud independently. And study there was, we paired up with a partner. My partner was always Ziggy Label. And we would go over the page we had studied and then try to, and then we would read commentary on it and the other commentary. And it's to their credit, two yeshiva bochum actually volunteered to work with us. I know Ziggy had his own private tutor, Avram Aaron, I've forgotten the second name. And I had my own private tutor, Avram Aaron Krieser, who was a German Jew who joined the yeshiva there. And they always told me, you know, what a brilliant head I had for the yeshiva, and I really needed to pay more attention because I really had a knack for this. And word got around the yeshiva that I was very good at the Talmud and what we were studying, which was amazing. I mean, I was 10, 11 years old. We were studying the laws dealing with theft, what would happen if two people find a garment and he claims it's his and he claims it is. How would you adjudicate this? And then laws about divorce and other kinds of laws. And typically what the Talmud was, it was a commentary on the sentences in the Bible. Now, you might have four words in the Bible, which would take two pages of commentary. Then there would be commentary on Rashi and Tosfos, who were on the. So the way the Talmud was written, the center would be the Talmud. And on each side, Rashi would have commentary on this, and then Tosfos would have commentary on this and on Rashi. And these were very elaborate, logically complex sorts of issues that were being discussed. They may appear trivial right now, but they were very complex. And I remember as a young kid really digging into that, and I loved the inference, and I loved, you know, the style of argument, which was called saying, well, if this is so, and then this is so, then this had to be so. So you had to develop logically sequential chains. And I got to be, you know, I'm afraid to say I got to be somewhat conceited about it. Now, a Talmud Chacham is somebody who is, in slang, it's a wise guy, but it's also known as somebody who is wise in the Bible, and I got to be known as being pretty good at this. And they had great hopes for me to be a real Talmudic scholar, and I began to consider myself quite a scholar at this because I was good at it. It was the first time that I recognized that I could reason well and quickly. And I reasoned quickly, and I could reason and spontaneously. And I began to make attempts to read the Talmud by myself, which was considered quite extraordinary, because many people take years and years to do that. And I took to it because, of course, we did no writing. We also didn't do any, there was no grammar, thank God, none of that. The thing that I did do, I remember vividly, the refugees developed a lending library. And I read voraciously, and there was nothing much to do in terms of entertainment, certainly at night. So you come home from the yeshiva, and we'd sit at home and we'd read. There would be books. That's the way we read about this Vicky Baum. I remember reading a lot of German books with my parents. We'd take a book out from the refugee library, and first my mother would read it, and my father, then I. Then we'd discuss it, and I did a lot of that. And my mother got worried that I was reading too much or too late. She mentioned it to one of the teachers in the yeshiva, and boy, did I get a lecture for that. Because, you see, reading stuff that was not connected with the Talmud was called bitul Torah, meaning a waste when I could be studying Torah. Who the hell could study Torah in bed with you? It just didn't make it. I was used to sitting with my partner and studying Torah. And they gave me a long lecture on how sinful it was to waste time which could be spent studying the Torah, but to read junk. Actually, some of it was pretty good. I read Leon Feuchtwanger and other stuff. And I was furious at my mother for having ratted on me. But eventually reached a compromise. I wouldn't read as much, but she wouldn't tell the rabbi that I was reading. But I actually began to read less because I began to feel that he was right, that the only worthwhile field of study was the study of the Talmud. And I did a lot of that, and I was very, very devout. And I remember kids, for example, boys are not supposed to start laying tefillin until they're 13 in their bar mitzvah. I started at 12. You're not supposed to fast till you're 13. I fasted at 11 out of devotion. I remember vividly one Yom Kippur. Temperature must have been 100. And it was just horrible. Not drinking. I remember at the end of Yom Kippur running down, and some guy, a member of the yeshiva, who was sort of like the caretaker, he had laid in, maybe 100 quarts of soda. And this is the only time in my life I finished a quart of soda without taking it off away from my. I just started, I couldn't, because I was parched. Not drinking was terrible, not eating wasn't so bad. And the holidays were really an awesome occasion because in the yeshiva everybody knew the significance of every word and its implications. And I really felt on Yom Kippur as if every word was being weighed by the Lord in terms of whether I would survive or not survive. And survival became a very real issue. And I saw people dying, attending funerals. I've seen Chinese people dying. And of course there was the continual subtext, what was happening to our families in Europe. We were all very worried about that. We never heard much about that. The one vivid memory I have is one day, and I did all my praying at the yeshiva, and then we'd generally walk over to my father's synagogue and meet him, both my parents, and we'd walk home together. One day, it was a Shavuos day, I happened to walk over, and my father was talking to Mr. Zolny, who had been a peddler, who happened to have been in Dachau with my dad. And my father was saying, I remember him saying, something like, if they're treating them anything like we were treated in Dachau, I don't know how they could survive. And then he saw me and he stopped talking. And we walked home. And I remember there was a grim walk home because I suddenly realized that if indeed any of our relatives were in camps like Dachau, that it would be impossible to survive. How would they survive? And I recalled how he had come home after 21 days, that he was just a shadow of himself. And from then on, there was, when we prayed for survival, for life, etc., on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, it was with great devotion and great terror and fear. Because after that conversation, I suddenly, for the first time, recognized that the families in Europe must be having a hard time. Now, we felt we were having a bad time because, food was scarce and all of that. The only people who were doing well were people in the yeshiva. They were eating cream and meat, and they had new suits being made, and there was a lot of feeling among the Jews in Shanghai that they were getting a lot of money, and we really had people dying mainly from malnutrition. I mean, it's not that they died from hunger per se, but that they were so poorly nourished that they couldn't withstand the various diseases from China.
There was no attempt on the part of the yeshiva to help out?
Not to my knowledge. There were funds, there were these emergency kitchens, and there were these things, but they were not directly connected with the yeshiva. Ultimately, that, of course, became one of the reasons I stopped being very religious after the war. But that didn't enter my mind, because I was being supported, too. I was getting about the equivalent of $5 a month, which was enough to keep us together. But life was getting hard, and I do remember vividly one, you know, we were all living in one room in the ghetto as well, waking up one morning and hearing my parents talking to one another in bed, and they were saying, as I recall it, that they were down to their last $17. Now, $17 was a fantastic sum of money, of course, because generally you trade in $1 on the black market for food. But it became clear to me that $17 was not a lot, and that they were really worried what would happen when they ran out of that. And then I suddenly realized that things were very, very difficult. While I was being, we had enough to eat. I was almost never hungry, but it was really meat. It was usually rice, and the bread we ate at that time often had worms in it, and everything was very poor quality. And a lot of people were in terrible shape. You could see refugees who were literally they looked like my father did after Dachau. They were shrinking into their clothes. They were pale. They were sallow. Illness was endemic. Everyone was ill. And I remember in 1944 I caught dysentery. It would mean I had to run to the bathroom something like maybe 5, 6, 7, 8 times a day.
You have to stop. We'll continue on the next tape. Tape number 6. Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. You were mentioning that you became ill with dysentery.
Yeah, and there was very little medication to treat the dysentery, to stop it. And what the physicians did, they gave me liver extract injections to maintain my health. And I had to avoid anything which would cause loose bowels. And I did. I lived mainly on bread, toasted bread. And toasting there was a difficult problem because electricity was so expensive that we couldn't use it. And basically we had little charcoal stoves which we started. You put a piece of bread on top of the charcoal and turned it around. A lot of tea and cereal type things, etc. And fortunately for me, the dysentery seemed to spontaneously disappear. The liver extract maintained my health, and so it disappeared, fortunately for me. What was horrible is everyone had intestinal worms, and since very few people in the ghetto had water closets, when you went to the toilet, you could see the evidence of the worms, and it was just a horrible thing to move your bowels and then see the worms slithering around. I remember having many a nightmare about that. It was just and typically you avoid it. I remember often withholding having to go to the bathroom till I went to the yeshiva, because the yeshiva and the Ohel Moshe had a water closet. We were able to go to the toilet there, and of course that was so much more pleasant than anywhere else. The other thing, talking about health, is I know I had a tooth. I needed to have a tooth pulled during the war. We had a dentist in the ghetto, and he gave me anesthetic to pull it out, and the tooth cracked in the middle of the extraction. And then he said that he couldn't give me another injection because there were two scares, the anesthetic and the rest of it. This was one of the most excruciatingly painful experiences, because the rest of it was pulled out as the anesthetic wore off. And I recall not going to a dentist for 18 years after that, and I still avoid dentists whenever possible, as you could well imagine. But for us, life in the ghetto got grimmer as food became scarce. People were hungry. People were dying from not being able to withstand diseases. The news we had were basically that we heard that we began to understand that the war was not going well for the Germans and the Japanese, because the way they've always put it, they were reducing the defensive perimeter. And the defensive perimeter was reduced first from Russia to Poland, and from Poland to Germany. Once we were in Germany, people had maps, and we figured out that life was going badly. They never talked about a defeat. They always talked about the defensive perimeter being reduced in order to fight the enemy more effectively, but we understood that meant that the war was going badly. For the most interestingly enough, most of us were more concerned with Europe than Japan. Even though we knew about the invasion, the first Bataan and then the return to Bataan and the whole thing, the defensive perimeter being reduced, etc., we knew about that. Then in the late 43, early 44, for the first time we began to hear that there were air raids. We saw planes, we couldn't make out that they were American planes, I mean, some high in the sky. And there was some attempt at anti-aircraft, but not very effective. And then a frightening thing happened. The Japanese asked that the owners of houses fronting the road drill foxholes. Well, basically what you took a slab of concrete, you had to take it out of the street and dig 3 feet deep. Now in Shanghai, when you dig 3 feet deep, what happens? You hit water. There was just no way not to hit water. And every house had these foxholes, and suddenly we got worried that, geez, they seemed to be expecting house-to-house fighting, expecting an invasion. It became clear to us that this is what was happening. Shanghai had no cellars, and we suddenly realized that very few people would survive house-to-house fighting because there was no safety. And we got really worried, people who'd been in the First World War, and then, of course, all of us saw the ruins of the war between the Japanese and the Chinese, and we suddenly realized that now it might be our turn for what was happening in Europe, and that it would be very difficult to withstand a frontal attack. But it became clear that the war had gone badly for the Japanese, and they were pulling back, etc. Then there were actual bombardments. We heard them in the periphery of Shanghai. You heard bombardments, and there were air raid sirens.
About when was this?
I would imagine that was beginning 45, late 44. With the bombardments, the point of where would we find safety, and people began to gather in doorways, because we had noticed when we moved into Shanghai that doors were standing longer than, not the doors themselves, but doorways were standing when walls had collapsed. People gathered there. And then someone must have negotiated with the Japanese, because pretty soon we were told that we could actually go into the jail. Some of the administrative buildings of the jail would permit us to come during bombardments. And those were the most solid buildings. They appeared to be concrete slabs, and there was a feeling of safety about that. And in early 45 or so, and towards the summer of 45, when there was an air raid siren, earlier, when there was an air raid, the refugees would be waiting, and they'd look up at the planes and they see them as liberators, because our feeling was that the Americans must know that we were in the ghetto and that they wouldn't bomb the ghetto. And there was waving, and there was some, not jubilation, but there was some happiness about that, because it was evidence that the Japanese would soon be defeated.
Did you hear about the end of the war in Europe?
Yes, we heard about the end of the war in Europe, and we felt that there were mixed feelings about that. And it was the war of the end of Europe, and the Japanese were going to go on. And on the one hand, it became clear to us that now all the attention would be focused on the Japanese. On the other hand, that may have meant that there was going to be an invasion. So we had very mixed feelings about that. And the greatest immediate impact of the war happened on the 17th of July, 1945. There was an air raid in Hankyu, and 41 refugees were killed. And I remember that whole experience very vividly, partially because my father, after the air raid, walked through one of the streets on Seward Road where there had been a direct hit, and saw the legs of a refugee under the rubble of a building and pulled him out, and indeed it was a refugee who had his throat slashed by a piece of shrapnel. Later on, we began to understand what was happening is that one of the buildings, which seemed to have a lot of antennas, was probably a major communication center for the Japanese army, and that they had tried to get that, and they had succeeded in getting that. But 41 refugees were killed, as were many, many Chinese. After that, everybody ran to jail. As soon as we heard an air raid, then we knew this was serious business. Fortunately, of course, it was the 17th of July, 45, and shortly thereafter, we heard in the Shanghai Jewish Chronicle, which by that time became a four-page paper, and a very poor stock, etc., It was a tiny article talking about a bomb having been exploded using atomic something. We didn't know what that meant, but there were some refugees who understood. And these people said, if this was truly what the paper said, then the war could not last long. This was incalculable damage. Next thing we knew became August, mid-August. And on one day in mid-August, suddenly, you know, we heard that thing, the news became very sketchy. And the Japanese simply disappeared. And we couldn't figure out what was going on. The Japanese were a constant presence. I mean, there were troops and all of that. And suddenly they disappeared. And within a few days, there were rumors that an American tank had landed. Indeed, of course, there wasn't a tank. It was a Jeep. A Jeep American. And that's how we found. It was really very funny in retrospect to think about that, because for 3 or 4 days, we heard rumors of surrender, the war end, but there was no news. There was no hard news. No one had hard news. And wherever the news that was being given to the Shanghai Jewish Chronicle came, that communication had broken down. And for a few days, nobody knew. We didn't know whether to celebrate or not celebrate. Because, you know, if we had made a mistake and the Japanese found out, we were going to be in for it. But then it turned out that the war was over, and we heard about the jeeps landing and that there were American forces coming, and that's how we found. Then, of course, there was great joy and jubilation. And underneath that, there was the fear about what had happened in Europe. We first heard about Treblinka. And then Auschwitz, of course, and Bergen-Belsen. And it was a horrible time because we had heard none of this. This was a total shock.
Do you know how the word came in?
Yeah, in the Shanghai Jewish Chronicle. Apparently, their news channels had gotten reestablished, and they published a series describing in great detail what happened to Treblinka. The gas chambers, the ovens. And then word began to trickle in through the Aufbau, which is a German Jewish newspaper, which began to be shipped as mail contact was reestablished with the United States, and lists of survivors. List of people who had
So was this a matter of people looking in the papers and searching the papers and looking for names?
The papers were posted as the Avba would arrive. It was posted who survived and who didn't. And all of the people I knew from Poland, all of my mother's family hadn't survived, with the exception of the Jaffes. We found that out later because they had been in the Soviet Union, so it took a long while for that news to trickle out. They were just unknown for a while. And then, you know, we heard about that. Pretty soon it became clear that virtually no one from my mother's family had survived. And it was horrible because I knew all these people well, having been in Poland every summer. And the most horrible memories I had were some of the people who had not survived. The only thing which came back to me, I remember vividly. The last fight I had with my cousin in Dembitz when I visited, the smartest of all the cousins, and he had not survived. And the only thing I can remember, at the last fight I had with him, I broke his glasses. And I had this horrible... You know, how could I have acted so badly? And of course, I should have died in his stead, etc., etc., etc.
And at this time, you were still not quite 13?
Not quite 13. And at the same time, Puppa, who was Zalo Blaufeld's sister, the last memory I had of her, I remember we visited their house, and she obviously had some problem on her buttock. She had a blister or something. And I figured out, because her mother and my mother, who was my aunt, were talking about it. And so my mother and her aunt and her mother decided to examine, and I peeked through the keyhole, and she found out. And of course gave me hell, and she didn't survive. She was a very pretty, very smart, very lively girl. Later on, I learned to call this survivor guilt. I didn't call it then. It was a horrible period. I think the major thing which saved me at that time from being more distraught than I was the fact that my bar mitzvah was approaching. And even though I was a very good student, it became clear my bar mitzvah would be a major event. My teachers in the yeshiva wanted me. I wouldn't just do the small section. I would read the whole section of the Talmud, of course. That was understood in the Haftorah. Then I was being tutored to hold a speech. And I worked on that. And then something called a pshetel. A pshetel is a commentary on the Talmud. And I was studying that. And I would, you know, so fortunately for me, a lot of my time was being taken up with these preparations. And throughout this, there was the feeling about, not only the people, but how could this God that I was praying to have permitted this to happen? And I think my first questioning, it wasn't real questioning, it was just puzzlement how this could happen. And I remember my mother put it extremely well to a Rabbi Liss, who had been influential in the small yeshiva. And she asked him one day, in my presence, she said, you know, how could God have permitted the most learned, the most Jewish part of the community to be destroyed? And he's used the Yiddish phrase, as in pachtein and pachtmanim and punim, which means if you hit someone, you hit them in the face. I never understood the logic of that. It was a continual puzzle to me. And, you know, I studied and I prayed and I did everything I did before. But I couldn't figure out how this could happen if there were a mercy. You know, I kept saying it's a merciful God, it's a just God, how this could happen. It was very difficult.
Was that the only time someone in the yeshiva discussed this?
No, it was discussed. There were meetings, there were memorials, and there were things. Now, greater faith was needed because the...
So that was the approach, you need more faith now?
Yes, greater faith, because who knew of God's designs and, you know, that sort of thing. And you know, I went along with all of that. And back of that, there was this puzzle. I mean, how could this happen? I just couldn't figure that out. Well, American troops began to enter Shanghai, and across the street from where we lived was something called the Repatriation Center. Ended up that in order to be rotated back into the United States, they would spend a few days in this CTRS, China Theater Repatriation Service, which is right across the street from where we lived. And the American soldiers began, hey, here's some kids who actually speak English. So we, and, you know, they would often take us in to see movies, and we saw the movies there, etc. And the day of my bar mitzvah arrived, and of course a lot of preparation. My parents baked up a storm. It was also therapeutic for them because they could get away from, you know, my mother and my father were gaunt during this period and very depressed. And The preparations got them out of it. My birthday is November 26th, and the bar mitzvah happened to be in October that year. And the bar mitzvah was going to be held in my father's synagogue, not in the yeshiva, and we're all prepared. And then a truly magical and major thing happened. As I went to shul that morning, and we got into shul, and the services began, an American... This was really a happy event, but a captain of the American Army This is harder than I thought it would be. It ended up that this captain was actually a rabbi. What was so hard about this, that at the same time that you heard about the Holocaust, seeing an American officer who was obviously an honored person, and he wore the Mogendolin on his belt. It was very puzzling for God to permit this at the same time. It was very puzzling. I had enormous difficulty reconciling that in my mind. But at the same time, seeing an American officer who was a rabbi was...
Had he come to the synagogue prior to this day
no,
at all?
No, he apparently had just been rotated through Shanghai on Friday. And found the synagogue. He was at the CTRS, or maybe he was somewhere else, but he heard about the synagogue, and he showed up to services. And obviously, he was the most honored guest immediately. And I did the whole thing. I did the reading from the Torah. I did the speech. I did the pshetel and all of this and that. And then his name is Gordon. Rabbi Gordon asked for the floor. And of course, and he said he apologized for having to speak in English, and he said he hoped that the people who couldn't speak, people who spoke would translate for the others who couldn't. And he held a very brief and extremely moving speech, which is why I'm crying now. And he said that he didn't know whether he'd find any Jews in Shanghai when he came, and he certainly didn't know whether he'd find a service. And when he found a service, he said he was absolutely amazed to find a service, you know, a bar mitzvah as steeped in Judaism and knowledge and wisdom as any he had ever attended. And then he said something which broke me up then, as it does now. He said, from then on, the words Am Yisrael Chai Am Yisrael Chai means the Jewish people will live in implication forever. There wasn't anybody in that synagogue who wasn't crying with that, because everybody had, the majority of relatives had made it. To suddenly have that. So, It was a great occasion. I mean, it was a happy occasion. But the fact that so many people indeed were not alive, and people who were very near and dear to me. And so there was a funny thing. There was the feeling of hope that there was a country where Jews were not persecuted. Where even, you know, the rabbi would be an officer, an honored officer. And at the same time, you had this other thing going on. So it was a very complicated, encouraging, wonderful, sad. The contrasts were incredible. And that was the most memorable for me. I mean, you know, what I did was less important than what Gordon said. And Michael, as a very numismatist, said he would put me in touch with Rabbi Gordon, who lives in Washington. One of these days, I hope to meet him.
You haven't had any contact?
I haven't had any. I haven't been able to identify him, but I'd like to have some contact and tell him how meaningful and important that was for me.
I'm sure you were meaningful and important to him.
I guess so. And
was this something that made the people feel that they wanted to go to the United States,
or
had they felt this way before?
Oh, yes. No, this has certainly helped. I mean, you know, as a matter of fact, not only that, it's an interesting thing my father said. Of course, we tried to revive our application for emigration, etc. And what began to happen is, as contact was reestablished, parcels began to arrive in the United States, distant cousins, relatives that sent us clothing, etc. Much of the clothing didn't fit, but just the fact that there was somebody who cared, that meant a lot. And we started getting rations from the army. There were the C rations, and we soon learned there was the K rations. And of course, then as a yeshiva boy, I couldn't eat most of them because they said shortening. We figured pretty out that shortening meant vegetable fats. And then we got a black market began with trading rations and stuff like that. You know, life began to resume. And people began to worry about where they would go and what they wanted to do. And of course, we wanted to go to the United States. And the continual concern, of course, was that we couldn't because my parents were still Polish quota. And the immigration law, which was enforced then, was enforced by national origin. Polish quota was infinitesimal. And so people began to make other arrangements. And I continued studying the yeshiva. And word had come out then by then that the yeshiva were getting $30 a month for every person in the yeshiva community. $30 a month was a fortune, perhaps the equivalent of $3,000 a month now, maybe more, $30,000. It was an unbelievable fortune. And a lot of resentment was expressed at the fact that none of this had been shared with people in dire need. I mean, $30,000 is a great deal of money. And that I began to sort of be puzzled about that. Well, people began to make plans to leave. And the yeshiva suddenly said that they would go to the United States, and they were getting student visas. And they would arrange for me to be invited to be a student at the Yeshiva Chai in Berlin. I had a letter of invitation which was sent to me that they would pick up my transportation and board and study and pocket money, etc. My parents said no way would they permit me to go across the ocean by myself, because at that time I was just 13, 14, this was 47 already, 14, 15. And what began to happen, of course, is the yeshivas did move. They did get student visas. And ultimately what happened is they went to the United States, went across the border to Canada, and then from Canada were able to get regular immigration papers and came to the United States. At this time, I was still in Shanghai. Then in 48, of course, there was incredible jubilation about Israel, the state of Israel. It was perhaps the single most joyous day that I remember in Shanghai. For me, the period after the yeshiva left was an extremely puzzling period. I didn't want to go back to the Kaduri school because there would be sort of an admission that I should never have left. On the other hand, what I began to hear what the yeshiva had done, and that left me with a bad taste in my mouth. And during that period, I think I was as close to being seriously emotionally disturbed as ever in my life, because I knew I was Jewish. But being Jewish meant being Orthodox, being part of the yeshiva. And after what I heard about that, the yeshiva, it was difficult for me to consider myself a yeshiva bohem. But if I wasn't Jewish, what was I? And It was a period of incredible anxiety, frustration. I guess the only word it was despair, depression and despair, and it was an extremely, I couldn't really find my way. I attended some of the Zionist meetings, and I really didn't fit in with that group. Then there was a very active Zionist group, the Bitar, who were very militaristic, and they would wear uniforms, much like the uniforms of I remembered of the Hitler Jugend, except now they had the Star of David on them, and I really couldn't identify with them. Nor could I identify with Habonim, which was a more socialist-oriented group. And I was at odds with everybody, including some of the other former yeshiva bochim. I felt uncomfortable virtually anywhere, and comfortable nowhere. And I would say all the prayers, etc., but there was very little meaning attached to any of the prayers. And there was an internal, really, feeling of despair, not quite knowing what I was and where I was. And during that period, I went to a business school for a few months, learned how to type and do some Greg shorthand, and then shortly thereafter took a job in an office in Shanghai where one of the partners was a son-in-law of Rabbi Ashkenazi. They were called Tugendhat and Milner, and they were doing textile things, etc. And I worked there as an office boy, clerk, all-purpose stuff. Well, what began to happen is the refugees began to leave, States, etc., etc. I was working, and
we're going to have to stop, and
okay.
We'll continue on the next tape.
Oh, I think I can make it. Thanks.
This is tape number 7.
Okay.
Today is October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. You were talking about people starting to leave Shanghai.
Yeah, people were leaving Shanghai. Those who had good quotas, German quotas, it was easy to leave, of course. And I began to think that maybe I should leave because I had German quota and my parents would follow me. In the meantime, I was working there, and for the first time in my life, I found something about inflation. At one time, let's say one American dollar was worth like 30 Chinese dollars. To cut a long story short, by the time I left Shanghai, it was 12 million. And what began to happen is every few weeks the Chinese government would issue a new currency. The new currency, one of the new was worth 100 of the old, etc. And I felt very sorry for the Chinese because what happened is they would literally, the minute they were paid, they would run to buy rice because tomorrow was worth less. I was paid in American money, which of course was illegal, so we didn't have those constraints. And what I did at that time began to be relatively risky. Every business, you couldn't conduct business in this kind of an environment. Everybody was trading on the black market and American money. As a 15-year-old and as a trusted 15-year-old, I was ended up being the messenger. And I would sometimes, I remember the most money I ever carried in my life, I carried $55,000 of American money in my pockets, 5,000 cash, the rest in checks, from one place to another to the trader. Well, my parents found out what I was doing. They didn't want me to take such risks, even though we were told that if I was caught, nothing would happen. And it was true. You could bribe your way out of anything at that period. The Kuomintang was falling apart. And so I ended up, and this was interesting, I ended up working for a part of the business where we were selling retail some of the textiles that this company was trading in. And I was on Avenue Joff in a fur store, and we had two counters in the first store to sell textiles. My major job was I would call up the trader three or four times a day to find out the current exchange. And when a customer would come in, I would set the prices because I knew what each item would have to bring in American currency, and I would set the prices for that. And then I, for the first time in my life, I attended the a synagogue in the French section, the new synagogue, which became important later on. What also happened is after the war, I got tired of being a sheaf cop because yeshiva left. Kids were calling me sheaf cop again. And amusingly enough, we went to a surgeon, a German surgeon, Heilbronn, I think his name was. And he looked at it and he said, that's a simple piece of surgery, but anesthesia would be required. And said it was a muscle at this side which had to be severed. Well, my mother was absolutely opposed to surgeries. She had surgery in Germany, gallstones, which at that time in 37 was very serious surgery. And she was opposed. And so she decided, I decided, well, let's go to the rabbi, and the rabbi will tell us whether to have surgery. She wanted to go to the Amshin of her rabbi, who, because her family was from that area. He looked at me and he said, oh, yeah, but it's more important to have, to be spiritually upright than to be physically upright. So my mother was victorious, etc. She was happy about that. I was not happy about that, obviously. So I insisted that we go to the Mashgiach, who was a truly holy and a saintly man. My mother immediately told him what the Rebbe had said, that he said, yeah. The Mashgiach looks at me, he says, oh, I don't see anything wrong in fixing it. So that was that. And I had surgery in, I believe, in 47, and my sheaf cup stopped being a sheaf cup. And that was in the Shanghai Jewish Hospital on Rue Perchon, which was kind of interesting because I was there for 2 weeks. And the surgery was uneventful. I had anesthesia and all of that and went off well. And then the yeshiva left. And I was still in the state of despair and doubt as to what was going on. And gradually it became clear that the communist armies were advancing to Shanghai. And it became clear that we had to get out. My parents still couldn't get out. And then we reached the decision that I would go to the United States as a regular immigrant because I had German quota, even though I was only 15. And the logic was that if with me here life would be easier, worst came to worst, I would go to Israel, or at that time my parents were speculating perhaps to join relatives in Australia or Israel or the United States, never Europe. There was no, my parents had no interest, no desire ever to go back to Europe. August 1948, I came to the United States. I got on the SS General Gordon and came to the United States by myself, traveling. You know, it's sort of amusing. It's 15,000 miles all by myself. And I was met by someone from Shanghai and people from the joint when the ship docked in San Francisco. And I spent a few days in San Francisco. The most amusing part about that is, you know, we hadn't had any grapes at the time in Shanghai. And, you know, California grapes are wonderful. And I remember gorging myself on saffron grapes. I would buy them by the pound and devour them in my little hotel room. And my digestive system took a terrible beating because of all the fruits I was eating. But gradually, you know, that subsided. And I took the transcontinental train to New York, the United States. And there, for the first time, I was reunited with the Jaffees. Max and Ziggy Jaffe and their parents, Malcha and Favel, had come from Siberia to a displaced person camp, from displaced where they came to the United States. And my cousin, Saul Blaufeld, who was the only member of his family to survive, was living in Washington. And so when I arrived in the United States, the Jaffees were waiting for me at Penn Station. And the joint took care of me because the Jaffees had a three-room apartment for, let's see, Max at that time had gotten married, so there were five of them in a three-room apartment, so it was decided that I would eventually stay in an orphan home, and I spent 6 months at the Hebrew National Orphan Home in Yonkers. Problem then became, what are we going to do with this kid who had no formal schooling? I had no secular education. I was literate. I could read. I spoke English quite well, but I really had no formal schooling. So since the placement in the orphan home was considered temporary, I attended a junior high school there. Eventually, the joint decided to place, because at this point my parents were still in Shanghai, to place me with a family in Brooklyn. I attended New Utrecht High School, and the principal there, an Irish man by the name of Griffith, a very nice man, interviewed me. And he talked to me, and he knew, and I told him I could read, etc. He said, look, why don't we do this? He said, we'll try you in your chronological age, which would be sixth term. And if you have difficulty, you come to see me, and we'll adjust it. But that seems to be the most reasonable thing. So I got put in sixth term, and sure enough, the first 2 weeks I was terrified because I figured, you know, maybe all the problems I had in the Kaduri school would reappear. And I studied the way I did in the yeshiva. And then I found out that, you know, I got 98s, 90s, every test. And I suddenly realized I didn't have to work so. And then I studied a little less, and I still got 90s. And then, of course, I wanted to have some pocket money, and I began to work 20 hours a week in a vegetable store, grocery store. And my grades suffered slightly, but not materially. I was still getting B pluses, etc. And I worked through all that period. At this point, Congressman Seller, who has really saved the lives of many of the people who were remaining in Shanghai. The law then in place said that displaced persons could immigrate to the United States outside of the visa channels. Shanghai Jews were not considered displaced persons. Sella had a law or an attachment or a rider passed to indicate that the Shanghai people should be treated as displaced persons. Suddenly it became possible for my parents to emigrate to the United States because they had DP status. And in May of 1950, I arrived in 49. A year later, they followed me. And our family was reunited in New York. My parents followed me on the 1 month before Mao Zedong marched into Shanghai. My parents left Shanghai. The one thing I do want to point out is during this period, when it was clear that they would immigrate to the United States, you could see the difference between having an Israel and not having an Israel. The Israeli government obviously had found out that there were Jews in Shanghai. They simply sent, they chartered three tiny little steamers, Greek ships. And my parents wrote to me about this, and I never saw it, so this is all hearsay. But three tiny little ships made their way up the Huangpu River with Israeli flags. And after all the trouble we had with visas, anybody who was Jewish could get on the ship. And most of the Shanghai Jewish community went to Israel, remaining in 1949. By that time, perhaps half and perhaps more had left. The three ships took anybody who wanted to go. No visa. No tickets, no anything. Now, there were a few people who were left, perhaps 1,000 or so, made their way to the United States. Then a very small group could not make its way to the United States, and the communists marched in and they were caught. And what happened then was sort of tragic in retrospect. I mean, not as tragic as Europe, of course. Ultimately, an agreement was struck that these people would come to the United States and would then be shipped from San Francisco to New York on a train which was locked because the American government was worried that they would escape and become illegal immigrants. And these people made their way across the United States. A friend of mine, Robert Knopp, was part of this group. And then they came to New York. In New York, they got on ships and were sent back to Europe. Some of these people wanted to go to Israel. And for example, when the ships tried to make their way to the Suez Canal, by then they were not permitted they were not permitted on the deck when the ship went through the Suez Canal in fear that they would try to dive into the water, etc. They made their way to Austria and Germany, where many of them had pensions. You know, they're entitled to pensions, and many of them had property, etc. And a small percentage, maybe 5% of the community, went back to reclaim pensions and possessions in Europe. Most of the rest ended up in Israel, the United States, some in Australia, some in Canada, some in other sorts of places. And of course, I ended up in New York ultimately and went to the City College of New York. As a matter of fact, that was kind of troublesome because I didn't quite know what the hell to do with myself. It was clear I did visit the Mir Yeshiva once in New York. And as I walked into this place, I suddenly realized that I was looking at it with different eyes. I was no longer a yeshiva bocher. I came to see them. I didn't come to see us. And I made a decision then that I would not return to the life of a yeshiva student. I would go to secular school. And it's at that point that I stopped being Orthodox, pretty well. And then when I graduated high school, I had the embarrassing situation because I had no formal education for such a long time. I couldn't take an SAT, and I didn't have a high school average, so I had to enter City College as what they call a special student. And to demonstrate that I was academically competent over the first 30 or 60 credits, I've forgotten which it was. So I ended up having a B-plus average over the first 30 credits or so, and I was accepted as a regular student. But since my parents needed my support, for the first 4 years of my, actually 4.5 years of my undergraduate education, I worked full-time. I went to school in the evening. And then I learned how to play the game, I guess. In my last semester, I needed elective courses. I majored in psychology. I needed elective courses, which were not available in the evening. So I got fired and collected unemployment insurance for 9 months and went to day session and finished and graduated. and subsequently took a master's degree in school psychology and a PhD in clinical psychology. And then it's funny how life is. I ended up being a faculty member at the institution where I was a student for many years at the City University of New York. And in 1987 or so, my then dean, Leonard Beckham, wanted to establish a relationship with China. Thought it would be good for cultural exchange, et cetera, et cetera. And obviously, who's the natural guy to go to Shanghai? Me, obviously. And I was very eager to go. We established, and what happened, I should mention, I was invited to, I had by that point made a somewhat of a scholarly reputation. I was president of the Division of Educational Psychology of the American Psychological Association. I've had an active program of publication. I have a healthy vita, which weighs more, has more pages than I would want. And I was invited by a couple of German universities. And I simply couldn't bring myself to go back to Germany. I just couldn't do it. And didn't. And then something very strange happened. At a meeting which I gave a paper, I met some young Germans who came to talk to me. Spoke English fluently. They were young and very nice people. They seemed very different from the people I remember. So the next invitation I had was in 83. I was invited to an international meeting, interestingly enough, on test anxiety in Berlin at the Free University, and I returned to Berlin. My wife and I went back to Germany. She was born in Heidelberg area. And we visited Metzestrasse and all the places, and that's where we saw that the back of the building had been bombed out. Interestingly enough, the Riekestrasse Synagogue was then in East Germany, and the Riekestrasse Synagogue had survived. And what had happened, apparently, is because it was in this courtyard, which I mentioned to you, was attached to other buildings, they were afraid if they bombed it, that they would also bomb all the surrounding apartment houses. It had never had suffered a direct hit. During the war, the Germans had made a, they had horses there, a Stall in German.
Stable.
Made a stable of it. And after the war, it became the showcase of the East Berlin government, that this is the one synagogue they revived. Now, it was leaky and all of that, but of course we went there to services, and we saw the synagogue, and I brought a book. And it was really sort of depressing. There were 9 people at the Saturday service in the synagogue, which could accommodate perhaps 2,000 people. And the ceiling was leaking, all of this or that, but it had survived, and I returned to that. And I returned to Germany 2 years later because my daughter studied at the Free University and gave another talk. And after that, I said simply that I have no need to go back to Germany ever again. Then the business with China came up, you know, a return to Shanghai. And I said, well, I'd certainly be interested. But I also had some concern about it. I know I had some orthopedic difficulty then. I didn't know. I knew it would be a difficult trip. I didn't know whether I could get treatment. But finally, the arrangements were made. And sure enough, in 1988, in October. Oh, the other thing which happened then is I had been asked to speak. The Museum of the Holocaust had heard of I had talked about my experiences during Kristallnacht. And they had an audio tape of my recollections of Kristallnacht, which somehow or other made its way into WETA magazine in Washington, which is the channel, the public radio channel. And some of my colleagues called me and said, I saw your latest publication, which is kind of amusing. And I told some of the same story I've told over here. And I was invited to speak at a 50th anniversary meeting of the Kristallnacht by the Museum of the Holocaust, where the German ambassador would appear. And interestingly enough, that was going to be 2 days after my scheduled return from China. I'd gone to Shanghai October, early November. I went back to Shanghai, and I was met at the airport by people from the Shanghai Institute of Education. I was a visiting professor, scheduled to lecture to 85 principals about new developments in learning and instruction, which is my specialty now, in addition to test anxiety. And they met me, and it was great honor, et cetera, and we had communicated. And there was a man called Mr. Xu, who was my translator. And I was going to have quarters in what was the guest house of the Shanghai Conservatory of Music. I arrived late at night, didn't quite see what it was all about. I got up the next morning, and it seemed like a puzzling building. Turns out, as I talked to a few of the other foreign scholars who were staying there, there were mainly Chinese, but a few of us, Believe it or not, the guest of the Shanghai Conservatory of Music used to be the Belgian embassy to Shanghai. And I said to myself, my God, with the Belgians, why we ended up in Shanghai. What an incredible coincidence that was. And then my translator arrived in the morning and he said, well, they didn't schedule any formal activity for me just to recover from the trip. We'd take a walk. And as we walk along, the place looks familiar to me. I said, gee, this is very familiar. It was called Fenyanglu. And I said to him, do you know, what was the name of the street before? He says, I don't know. Before the revolution. I said, I don't know. This was 40 years after the revolution. It looked familiar. Then I look at him and I said, is there a hospital near here? He says, oh, yeah. The Shanghai Otorhinological Hospital is a block and a half away. Of course, the Shanghai Otorhinological Hospital is the Shanghai Jewish Hospital where I had neck surgery. We walk there and I suddenly realize I'm on Rue Prichon, which was now Fenyanglu. And then it all began to click. The Shanghai Conservatory of Music used to be known as the French Club. And now it was the Conservatory of Music. And the Belgian Embassy was the guest house. We walked to Fenyanglu, where the Rue Prichon was, and then I suddenly realized the new synagogue was a block away from the Rue Prichon. So I asked him, where is there? There must be a big synagogue. He said, we don't have any synagogues in Shanghai. But he says, we have a big auditorium, the auditorium of the Shanghai Institute of Education, the place I was visiting to lecture at, had this auditorium. And I say, okay, I want to see the auditorium. And of course, as I walk into the auditorium, it's the new synagogue where I had attended service at the end of my stay in Shanghai. And I remember searching for a founding stone, but there wasn't any. We walked up, where was the women's section, etc. Next day, I meet with the president and his deans, and they decide on what I would do, and they wanted to meet me, etc., etc. And I say in passing, he says, oh, I recognize your auditorium. He says, oh, yes. He says, it used to be a synagogue. But we've taken it over because there's no more Jews in Shanghai. But he says, you know, when you return, we'll give it back to you, which was really very sweet of him. And they were very gracious to me. And they had a car at my disposal and a driver and my interpreter. And they told me anytime I wanted to visit Hankyu, I could. And indeed, I visited it three times. And the first time I went back to the 737 lane. And that was rather interesting because I was the first returning refugee. And when I walked into the lane, I knew immediately the house where we had lived. The people, they wouldn't believe that I had ever lived there. Simply wouldn't believe it. All of this through the translator, of course. So it happened that the building next door used to be a textile warehouse. It was now a department store. I asked them, when did it stop being a textile warehouse? The occupants looked at me and said, my God, you did live here. And you have a very good memory because I've been in the department store for 25 odd years. And then we went to the second place where we lived in the ghetto. And by there, I was the second returning refugee. Rita Ataman had visited before, and they knew all about us. And they expected us, etc. And then we went walking around Hankyu, and my interpreter was absolutely amazed because he says, over here, you can tour me. I said, sure, I could walk my way. I was puzzled when we drove in the car, but as soon as I could walk, I made my way around it. And of course, I wanted to go back to the Ohel Moshe Synagogue. This was an interesting. The synagogue had now become a psychiatric hospital for the severely disturbed, acutely disturbed. Now, in anticipation of this, I had cards printed identifying myself as a professor at the City University faculty. And I go into the courtyard of the synagogue where I had my meeting, where I had that examination with all the students. And the guard points the way out. I says, I don't want to talk to him, to my interpreter. I want to speak to the director of the institute. So the director comes out, and I explain that I'm a psychologist teaching at the City University of New York. And I said, nothing I'll see in this hospital is new to me. I've interned in psychiatric hospitals. But this is not a professional visit. It's a personal visit, and I explain about the confirmation, etc. The guy gives me the run of the place immediately. And I walk up where I had my bar mitzvah in the center there, and I had a ping pong table, where they had the women's area, where they had made offices, and where the Talmud Torah was, where I had started studying, where the women's wards, and the women were severely disturbed and heavily, heavily medicated. And they were totally out of it. In back of the synagogue used to be a matzah factory, which the refugees used to make matzah on Passover. That was now the men's ward. And these guys were pretty well together. They wanted American cigarettes and stuff like that. And they were pretty well together. And I had the incredible experience, and my wife visited me for a week of my four-week stay in China. And on, I guess, my last visit to Hankyu, we were taking pictures. I had a camcorder, and my wife had our single-lens reflex. And some guy asked the interpreter why we were taking so many pictures. And he explained that we'd lived here 40 years earlier. And the guy said to him, hasn't changed much, has it? You know, he was right. It really hadn't changed much. Shanghai was substantially unchanged, really.
Did you visit the buildings that had had the yeshiva?
Oh, yes. Those were pretty decrepit now, and they had been converted to apartments. And our old room, which we had in the Wayside Road, was now also an apartment, a single room, and they gave us the run of the place, and that was all very nice. And there was really no real sign of our life there. Although on my last week, they gave me the obligatory banquet for visiting dignitaries, and this chancellor of the public schools of Shanghai arrived, a man called Yuan Kai. And during this banquet, he said, oh yes, he said he knew about the Jews of Shanghai. I said, oh, how do you know? Well, it ended up that his office, where the chancellor presided, used to be known as the Shanghai Jewish School, not the school I went to, and there was another Jewish school. This was now his office. So he knew about our existence, and the president knew about our existence. Otherwise, it had sort of disappeared. Though I've given to understand that by people who visited subsequent to my visit, that indeed the Oral Moshe Synagogue has now become a museum to the experience of the Jewish refugees. And I have no reluctance to return. I'd be happy to return. And my lectures dealt with new developments in learning and teaching, et cetera, et cetera. And we got six or seven lectures, and the principals were very attentive and very nice. And my last visit, I did a prepared thing, which was very moving to me and to some of the principals. What happened, my translator and I would usually meet a couple of days before my lecture, and I would outline it so he could look up the technical vocabulary. And typically, I spoke for about 30 seconds, then he would translate. And this thing, I really wrote out a script. I said to him, the very last thing I wanted to do, and I can almost quote it verbatim, I wanted him to translate it verbatim, that I told him that I was happy to have returned after 40 years and to be welcomed so warmly and with such hospitality at Shanghai the way so many of our community had 40 years earlier, 50 years earlier. This was 88, and we came in 38, 39. And I said to him that I had special warm feelings for China because even before and after, words like Auschwitz and Treblinka made their way into our vocabulary, we had been welcomed and lived side by side with the Chinese people in peace and relative comfort while we all had a bad time. Our life there was really blessed compared to what it would have been had we stayed in Europe with the Auschwitz and Belsen then. I know that I was very moved when I said that, and I said it, of course, feeling it very deeply. And I noticed that many of the principals were also very moved by it. One passing little comment I'd like to finish on, really, was that we visited lots of schools in addition to my lectures, and we visited one school fairly close to where we lived in Shanghai, in Hankyu. And usually after the meeting, after we visited, we'd listen to some lessons, and then the principal, the vice principal, we'd all gather, we'd have tea, and we'd make comments. And during this period, I looked at the principal, I said, you know, if my life had turned out differently, I would have been one of your students. And she loved it. And I loved it too, because I found I had none of the feelings of awkwardness, etc., that I'd had about Europe, because while our life was difficult and unpleasant, and dangerous, etc. Of course, it was heaven compared to what would have happened to us in Europe. And I have only feelings of graciousness and joy about that experience because what I've learned subsequently, of course, was that the German ambassador tried to get the Japanese to build gas chambers to liquidate the Jewish community in Shanghai. That in fact the Japanese did accede to that pressure and kept putting us into the ghetto and then eventually did build gas chambers, but fortunately they never used them. They had no inherent feeling of anti-Semitism. They did have some feeling about, apparently, a historian by the name of David Kranzler, who studied the papers of the Japanese foreign ministry, found that they were so welcoming to us because in the Sino, and there was a war which the Japanese won against Russians, and a Jewish man by the name of Schiff had put together a financial package which enabled the Japanese to beat the Russians. And they thought that the Jews were such talented financial manipulators, etc., that if the war went badly for them, perhaps they could have a way of approaching the American government through the Jews, and that's why they welcomed us. And indeed, an emissary visited Rabbi Stephen Weiss in 43-44 and asked him to tell President Rosenfeld, they thought Roosevelt was Jewish, about how well they're treating his co-religionists. And this man was kicked out of the rabbi's office. It was a super patriot. And in such an ironic and really stupid way, the lives of 15,000-16,000 people were saved. The Japanese really thought that we would be a back channel which would help them establish relationships. And if it weren't for this really stupid thing, none of us would have survived.
Now, when you return from... We'll have to stop now. We'll continue on the next tape. It's October 30th, 1997. This is an interview with Sigmund Tobias. When you returned from Shanghai, you mentioned that you were planning to give a speech on the 50th anniversary of
Kristallnacht. That's correct. I'd been invited to speak at the 50th anniversary of Kristallnacht. The Museum of the Holocaust had not been built yet, but the plans were well advanced, and the group that was organizing that had invited me to speak. And indeed, I did speak for only about 5 minutes, and I talked only about the experiences of Kristallnacht, which I've described here before. The most remarkable thing to me was, after the meeting, and I was moved at the meeting, as were a lot of people, by the Kristallnacht story. We were having punch after the meeting, and cookies and cake, and a very sort of distinguished-looking gentleman walked up to me. And he identified himself as Ambassador Rufer, the German ambassador. And I was speechless for a moment. And the only thing I could say is really what I feel about it now. I shook his hand and said, you know, I'm really glad to see you at this meeting. And he indicated that indeed he was and would be in touch. And of course, we never were. But I was glad to see that because, of course, there's another generation. And the whole problem of... what are the responsibilities here is a very complex problem, and I didn't want to go into that. But he obviously was a man of good intention in coming to this meeting, and I was happy to have seen him there. And for me, it was a sort of a closing of the circle because, you know, having been in Shanghai literally 2 days earlier and suddenly having him here in the Kristallnacht and all of that, it's not that I want to put the experience behind me, it'll always be part of me, of course, but it was a closing of the circle and lending a sense of closure to that experience.
To go back a little, just pick up a few things, how did your parents make an adjustment to the United States?
Well, my parents, when they came here, of course, peddling was not something my father wanted to do, and basically what they did is they bought a small grocery store after they were here a few months. After the war, we had saved little money, and I brought some of that money with me, which is another story which I don't need to go into. But we had a little money, and they bought a small grocery store on Legion Street in Brooklyn. I think the original was in Saratoga Avenue, then they moved it. They had three little grocery stores. And the life of a grocery man in the United States for them was pretty well 6.5 days a week, 12 hours a day. And they managed to eke out a living through that, and I helped when I wasn't attending classes and when I wasn't working. Throughout that period, I worked full-time. I had jobs as a copy boy for Time magazine. I worked at the New York Stock Exchange as a page. I worked for the United Service for New Americans, and I did various other things until I got my degree. About towards the end of my undergraduate career at City College, I met my wife, Laura. At that time, City College had summer concert, the Lewison Stadium, I don't know, concert. And of course, I attended that, and what attracted my wife to me initially was the fact that I worked in the bookstore in the summer session while I was taking courses. I worked in the bookstore. And students at the bookstore had discount tickets for students, so the tickets which cost 30, the bleacher seats which cost 30 and 60 cents, were available for 15 and 30 cents. And when my wife found out that I could get these discount tickets, we became friendly. And then I got to know her, And that was about 53 or so. We were married in 1955, in February 1955. And shortly after, before actually, I guess I must have become a citizen shortly after that, we were married. And it was sort of interesting. Our whole family is a City College family, because after that, I did my master's degree at City College, as I indicated. And subsequently, when I was on the faculty, my wife started school, because we had two children, our two daughters, Susan, who was our older daughter, Susan Tobias, Tobias Shapiro, and Rochelle Tobias. And when Rochelle was in first grade, Laura went back actively to school. And wherever we lived, she went to school first at Brooklyn College, and then she went to Queens when we lived out there. And of course, then when I became a faculty member at City, we lived in the suburbs, and I would drive in, she joined me at City College. And in, I've forgotten the year, she graduated from City College, and it was an interesting ceremony. I was marching as a faculty member, and she was marching as a student. And our kids and my in-laws were in the audience, and everyone was very proud of that, of all of us having graduated from that institution. And of course, it's an institution I feel very strongly about. I was there for a long time, even though I'm now working at another university. But it was important in my life, because as a refugee without any funds, I really knew I had no idea what to do with myself. And I went to school in the evening at City College without any objective. It was just seemed to me, a Jewish boys go to school. I'd always gone to school, Jewish boys go to school. And I went to school and really began to, and that changed me, a major experience, because I began to associate with a lot of other students, some refugees, some others. Spent a lot of time learning new things. I mean, I learned about classical music, which I knew nothing about history, about art, about politics, about science. Then, of course, about psychology, which interested me enormously. For a whole variety of reasons, in addition to trying to figure out what I was all about and what people were all about. And that's where I subsequently took my degree, and in which I've made my career.
You've talked during the interview about the changes in your religious beliefs and, of course, the effect on them of the Holocaust. How have you dealt with them later in life? How have you ended up dealing with your religious observance?
I didn't go inside a synagogue for over 30 years, other than I would generally, to honor my father, I would go to high holiday services as long as we lived close to one another, which we did for some time. But after that, I didn't. We would visit them before Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, and we always had Seder together and Hanukkah. But Judaism meant nothing to me for many, many, many years. And then I was on the leave as a visiting professor at Florida State University, where I also did not affiliate with any of the Jewish groups on campus, even though that's not quite true. At City College, while I was a student, I was a president of Hillel. I identified strongly as a Jew, but not with the religion. And I was also active in ISVA, the Zionist Jewish Organization. And at Florida State, I heard that there was a congregation, which interested me not at all. And then I also heard, and as a matter of fact, saw a picture in the newspaper about a chavura, which is a group of Jewish people getting together to celebrate Jewish occasions and discuss topics of Jewish significance. And the leader of that chavura, who was then doing his PhD at Florida State University, was Michael Birnbaum, who is now, of course, affiliated with the VHS project. And I had no interest in joining that group whatsoever, but the laboratory where I was working as a researcher, the laboratory was called Center for Computer Assisted Instruction. One of the young people over there attended one of the meetings of the Chavur, and he said, "Hey, this is a really neat group. You really ought to go." I said, "Nah." Well, one day I finally went, and it was fascinating to me because the group was very welcoming, and what was interesting about it is that they were very eager for me to do anything I wanted to do, such as whether I wanted to lead prayers or sing a song, etc. But no one ever said to me, "Well, if you do this, why don't you do ABC?" They didn't try to make me feel guilty. And of course, my life in the yeshiva had been one of, and I guess at home as well, of most of my faith had been guilt-induced. And in the chavura, I found there were people who were very interested in my background, and I had, you know, of course, having studied so many years, knew all the prayers and all of that. And, well, gradually that began to happen as I participated in the services and then started helping and leading them with Michael. And then when I returned to New York, I still was not ready to join a congregation. One dose of yeshiva is more than enough, actually. Well, what happened, I guess I should get this on the tape as well. When my father died, he died 3 months after my mother died in 1970. The rabbi in his congregation was a Kohen, a priest, and he was not allowed to officiate at the funeral services. But the assistant, who was the shamus and also the cantor, officiated. And he said he had seen, and here's my father's casket there, and he said he had seen 3 months earlier how well-versed I was in Judaism, because, of course, when my father died, when my mother died to honor my father, I said shiva with him and participated in the prayers. And he said he had seen how well-trained I was, and now pointing to my father's casket, said, you know, this is the time for me to return to the faith. And I was appalled. But what's so interesting to me, in retrospect, I suddenly realized, when he began, I said to myself, oh, I know what I'm in store for. I know he's going to lay the guilt trip on me. And fortunately, I mean, it had no effect on me. I said, oh, it's going to be a rotten few minutes, and I gritted my teeth and went through that. And two Orthodox friends of mine who were at the service came and apologized for such a terrible, you know, not only bad taste, which was a horrible thing to do. And the saddest thing I could tell them, I looked at them, I said, you know, the saddest thing I can tell you is that to me, Orthodoxy, this is what it means, being made to feel guilty. And I reaffiliated with the Jewish faith to some degree, only to the degree that I won't permit people to make me feel guilty about what I do or what I don't do. The Chavuras helped me with that, the first one and the second one. We now belong to a congregation where I actually lead services, and Yom Kippur I lead one of the services, and I have a wonderful time, and I really enjoy it. And to me, it's a very emotional thing. Emotionally, I'm connecting with my predecessors, with my family, my parents, and the people who came before them. I have enormous difficulty when the rabbi suggests we should do one of the prayers in English, because even though I can understand the Hebrew, but the content is so abysmal that it bothers me. I'm really not a religious person anymore. And I affiliate with the religion as, to me, it's sort of with the history of my people. And I feel strongly about that. And, of course, I feel I'm one of the most Jewish people there is. I speak, I put my hands, I'm very emotional, I'm doing all the other sorts of things. But I'm not a religious person, and to me the religion is really a conduit in the sense that I'm affiliating with the history of my people, with the experience of my family and my people. And I think that's what it means to me now, and I'm very proud of some parts of that. I'm not so proud about other parts of that. But have no desire to formally affiliate with religion in the sense of becoming devout again. That's not something, it's not an issue. Mm-hmm. I don't have any concern about that.
Now that it's been actually almost 60 years since these experiences, is there any particular message that you'd like to leave now for your grandchildren, really, that we haven't mentioned, your two grandchildren?
Yes. Well, that's a very difficult question, I guess. Ultimately, we all have to be what we have to be. And the other message is that the most dangerous thing one can do is feel superior to other groups of people. That as soon as I hear that one group feels that they're very superior to others, and I don't care what the group is, I'm very troubled and very frightened. Because such feelings can lead to enormous disasters. Having, you know, grown up in an area where all the Germans felt that they were superior. When I hear Jews talking about being superior to other groups, it's something I'm very troubled by. And the only message I would want to leave to the grandchildren, that human beings are human beings, that we all have our difficulties, and that no one is superior. That we have different peoples through the histories have different talents and different strengths and different attributes. And the greatest job is for us to learn to live together in peace, sort of the way we lived in China. People of very different background, very different history, managed to live together very well. You know, we had our difficulties, but we lived together well. And my message is basically that. When I came to the United States, I remember I'd read about Uncle Tom's Cabin and other sorts of things, but when I came cross-country, I remember this very well. I happened to sit with a bunch of soldiers. I had difficulty sleeping on the train, and we would sit in the, there was sort of a lounge outside of the John's, and we'd sit there and talk. And we would get off the train whenever we could, and I got off at Albuquerque just to stretch my feet and walk around a bit. I walked into the bathroom. I saw it said white men and colored men. And I was really astounded. And in a strange way, even though I wasn't American, I was ashamed. I had trouble getting back on the train and sitting down with some of these soldiers, two of whom were black. It was as if somehow or other, in a strange way, I had been slapped in the face by that. And if there were a message, as you say, the message would be that that is a truly evil thing, and that it is incumbent upon us as human beings to try to live together as well as we can. It isn't an easy job often, but certainly the idea of one group being superior to another is the worst human error we can ever commit.
Is there anything else you would like to add?
I don't think so. I think I've spoken long enough, don't you?
Well, you've certainly made a wonderful contribution to Jewish history today yourself, and we thank you very much.
I'm pleased to do it. I can't say I'm glad to do it, because it wasn't always easy, but I'm pleased to do it.
Thank you.
This is a wedding picture of my parents, Moses and Frieda Tobias. They were married in Berlin, I believe, in 1931. And this and all the other pictures of Germany and Shanghai, we took to Shanghai and brought from Shanghai to the United States. Well, this is the first picture, I guess, of me. This is my mother and me, and I don't know whether I was a year old or so, but this is the first picture. So it must have been taken in Berlin in early 1933 or late 1932, since my birthday is November 26th, I imagine it was somewhere around there. Probably a month or two is what it looks like. I was a big baby, so I must have been 2 or 3 months old. But this is a picture of taken in Poland, in Szendyszew. I'm the young chap, Sigmund Tobias. My mother is standing right behind me, Frieda Tobias, and her sister Ida, or Itala, I guess, Geschwind, this was before she was married, is immediately to her right. This was taken, I think, in the backyard of the house in Szendyszew in Poland. This picture was also taken in Szendyszew. It's I am all the way over at the right, Sigmund Tobias, the young kid at the right. Behind me is my cousin, who Puppa Blaufeld, who was spending the summer in Poland as well and lived in Berlin. Her mother, she's my cousin, and her mother was my mother's aunt. I don't know who the other two young people in the photo are, but it was taken in Szendyszew, also in the front or backyard of the family house there.
Do you know what year it was taken?
No, I would suspect it was probably taken, I would imagine, looking at myself, it must have been 37 or 38. This is a picture of me, Sigmund Tobias, taken in Szendyszew. I was sitting on the motorbike, which I was so happy and proud about, that brought my the fiancé of my uncle, Aaron Geschwind, to Szendyszew for a visit. And it was pulled up on a stand in front of the house and business of the Geschwind family. This is a picture of my uncle, Aaron Geschwind, who is sitting behind his fiancée, Taubi, whose second name I don't remember, on the same motorbike that you've just seen, taken in front of the family house and business in Szendyszew, Poland. Probably 1936-37. This is a picture of my mother and my mother, Frieda Tobias, and me, Sigmund Tobias. I guess at that time we were Winstorf, come to think of it. That was the formal name at that time. Taken in Berlin, I believe, in 1938. It may actually be a little later. This may have been after my father had gone to Shanghai, because otherwise he would have been in the picture. So I strongly suspect it was probably early 1939. This is a picture of me, Sigmund Tobias, and my mother, Frieda Tobias. This is the picture which was on the passport, of her passport, as I'm indicated. She had Polish citizenship, and I was added to that until the age of 12. And that was a picture in the smaller form which was on the passport. Unfortunately, I cannot find the passport now, but that's the shot which was on it. This is a picture of my mother and me, my mother, Frieda Tobias, and me, Sigmund Tobias, on the deck of the Conte Biancamano, which is the ship that took us from Genoa to Shanghai in 1939. This is the summer of 1939. This is a picture of Mr. Goya, the Japanese official who was in charge of the Jews in the ghetto in Shanghai. And it shows a row of applicants for passes to leave the ghetto, either for a day or a week or a month. And he dispensed these after hearing the reasons for them. And that shows the folks waiting in line for him. Sometimes these lines stretched for several hours. I found this picture in Beit HaTefusot, the Museum of Diaspora in Tel Aviv. I'd given a talk at an international meeting in Jerusalem, walked into this museum with my cousin. We saw a sign which said, Jews in China. I had assumed that it described the Jewish community in Kaifengfu, which lived in China 400 years ago. But as I got closer to the pictures, I recognized there was our community from Shanghai. Then there was an album saying the younger generation, and I opened that album, and the fourth picture in the album was that picture over there, which shows a gym class at the Kaduri school, the SJYA school, and led by Leo Meyer, who's the teacher in the front. And the first kid on the right, on the right-hand side, is a picture of me in this gym class. You might also notice that the sweater is the same sweater I wore on the pictures in Berlin, which is how my wife recognized that it was a picture of me. And that was an extremely moving moment, because I had never seen that picture before. And when I looked at it, I was dumbfounded and speechless for a whole minute. And then, of course, we went to see the people at the museum, and they came up and identified the picture, and I arranged to get reprints of it. And that's that picture, which, of course, is now in my office and at home. It was a striking feeling to find yourself in a museum unbeknownst to you. This is a picture of the Heimer, which I have obtained from the Leo Beck Institute. It shows the difficult conditions in which the refugees who couldn't afford to live even in a single room lived. There's a sort of communal living in the sense you see the double deck, the bunk beds, and the clothing hung up there, and you don't quite see. But at the edge of it, on the right-hand edge, you can see there's a blanket hung for some privacy between different beds. But those are the conditions the folks in the Heimer had to live in, and that was certainly a very difficult life. This is another picture of the Heimer, also obtained from the Leo Beck Institute. What you see over there are the people drying their laundry, and this is the outside. I believe it was the Schofang Road home, which was perhaps a 10-minute walk from where we lived on Broadway in our first house. This is a picture of my parents and I on the day of my departure from Shanghai to the United States. My father, Moses Tobias, is on the right. I, Sigmund Tobias, am in the center. And my mother, Frieda Tobias, is on the right-hand side. The ship is the SS General Gordon, President Lines, which I left Shanghai early in August. I think it was August 3rd or 4th, 1948. This is perhaps an hour or so before my departure from Shanghai. This picture was taken in 1949 after my parents' arrival in New York. It was taken at Brighton Beach. My father, Moses Tobias, is on the right. I, Sigmund Tobias, am in the center. And my mother, Frieda Tobias, is, I'm sorry, I guess she's, and she's all the way over at the left. And as I said, it was taken in Brighton Beach in, I imagine, the end of the summer, 1949. This is a picture taken at my wife's and my wedding. Going from the left is my wife's mother, my mother-in-law, Selma Sussman, born Oppenheim. Next to her is her husband, Ludwig Sussman. And next to them, I believe I appear, that's Sigmund Tobias. And between, next to them is my wife's grandfather. His name is Simon Oppenheimer. At that time, he was 98 years old. It was the last time he left his house. Next to him is my wife, Laura Tobias, born Laura Sussman. Next to Laura is my mother, Frieda Tobias. And next to her is my father, Moses Tobias. As I said, it was taken at our wedding, February 13th, 1955,
in New York.